enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Damn, that was a bit harsh.
What the hell is wrong with me?
How old are you?
I know. What the hell is going on? Hi.
Wow, the toddler survived that plane crash.
It has to get
breaking
that.
News.
Yeah.
Jet with 150 on board plunges into the Indian Ocean, and the toddler survived.
Another one of these Airbus. So, was in high wind. What the fuck is that? A plane in wind. It's supposed to be windy up there.
These fucking Airbuses. Does this sound weird to you? It sounded okay.
Yeah, I'm not hearing like loud sharp. Enough or something. A little weird. I don't know.
The fucking Airbuses. Yeah, wind should not be a problem when you're on an aircraft.
No, it's made to be in the wind.
How did the toddler survive?
I don't know.
Toddlers need constant care.
The sole survivor of this plane crash.
What was it just floating out there?
Saying that it happened like this. Doesn't that suck? Fucking thing can't even talk. Knows everything that happened. And just wants a coochie coo under the chin.
But how did it survive? What was it in?
I don't know.
Did it swim?
That's because toddlers have no clue what's happening.
True. They don't brace. They don't tense up.
They just sit there and get jostled around. They could be dropped on their head. It don't matter.
There's a case a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago, whatever it was. It was a Chinese, 500 people on the plane, and it was what they call porpoising. It was up and down. And they lost control, and they crashed into the side of a mountain. And everybody on the plane was killed, except I think two babies survived. That's the only people that sometimes survive these things.
Amazing.
But we don't have any further details on. I got to know what.
Not yet. That kind of just happened.
I mean, because the toddler wasn't putting on its own little fucking life vest or anything.
Yeah. Yeah, I know.
So how the fuck did it survive? It's
probably floating in a little seat. In its little baby seat.
Amazing.
Just thinking, like, that's how the trip goes.
Yeah.
They don't know any better. Oh, is this it? We crash into the ocean, and then someone picks me up, and my trip continues.
I guess we'll find out more. The guys down the hall will get it. Well, the big news, Bernie Madoff is going away for the rest of his life.
150
poor
years.
Man.
150 years.
Poor man. I just want to take the opposite side to make a discussion.
You know, they're saying this is like the first case in history that no one is on his side. Like
not
nobody.
One person.
Like usually when you're being sentenced, you get family members or close friends to come forward and go, you know.
He fucked everybody,
He's really a good guy. He was my father. He was this. No one.
Yeah, or at least to say, well, he's getting up there in age, and here's a character witness. You know, he was a very nice guy.
Yeah.
Nothing.
That's the headline in this whole thing. Not one person came forward on his behalf yesterday when they were sentencing him for his crimes.
Bon voyage, they say.
Well, like Jimmy said just before the show, hopefully it's hard time and not one of these soft prisons.
Because you know something? With a sentence like that, I don't know. They usually sentence these guys, the white-collar criminals. It's when they get like 19 months or something. They give them minimum security country club thing. When you're in for 150 years, I think they're just putting this guy away somewhere and
letting him rot.
Yeah, let him rot.
He should be forced to mix with. The problem is they won't, because he's so famous, they
Gen
won't
pop.
Let him. Gen
Pop.
Exactly. You want him to mix with. Crips and Bloods and Latin Kings, all these young angry dudes.
Oh my god!
Like that's what he should have to deal with. Is
mix him in with
prison.
People that understand a scam, basically.
Aw, yeah. Imagine that. Him in the middle of that.
Nothing's gonna happen to him. Come on.
They got struggling in the weight room with like 5 pounds.
They got to bring back Hard Time.
Yeah.
Have him break rocks. For the next 150 years.
Shackled to
some other inmates.
Hardcore prisoners.
Just breaking rocks, and then you speak up. Why are we breaking rocks? Just because we can make you do that.
Yeah,
because
that's that's what we do now.
Or maybe a chain gang.
Yeah.
Pick up some litter on the highway. Because I think prison just becomes your life.
Yeah,
in the end.
This guy's life was pretty fucking sweet.
Yeah, but after
some pretty sweet numbers.
A year or two, it becomes his life.
Yeah.
I'm telling you.
Yeah, he'll fit right in like Brooks or something. He'll run the library. Either that or he does have some financial knowledge. Mm. He can maybe do the taxes for the guards some of the other people.
Let me tell you, he helps a few people invest right, though. The guy like that might not get the shipping out of him, because they might use him for how smart he is.
Do the books for the warden?
Wait a minute. Change his shoes out?
Yeah.
But they may go, hey, you got any tips? And he starts throwing out tips. Guys start looking out for him. Guards look out for him. If he helps you make some money on the outside, yeah. I mean, I guarantee he would be able to at least guide you into a good investment.
Might work out for him.
Well, the good news, he's done.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
He's done. Hey, we know why the toddler survived. Let's say hi to Garth in Indiana. Garth?
Good morning, boys.
Hello, Garth.
What's up, Garth?
Hey, I heard the reason that kid survived the plane crash was because he was in the lap of an older gentleman.
Oh. I see. Because
I hope
why?
We didn't lose Uncle Paul on the flight. Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Stop it.
What else is going on in the world?
Oh, my God.
Well, the Michael Jackson thing gets
debacle
more and more interesting. Why the fuck is Reverend Al hanging out with Joe Jackson? He's by his side the entire time.
Because he's in the news.
Reverend Al.
That fucker can't keep his face out of the news.
Reverend Al flew out to L.A. He felt like his presence was needed to make sure Michael Jackson's taken care of in death. What a fucking phony this guy is.
Is there any doubt that this guy is nothing but a publicity-seeking shithead?
Isn't there a bunch of other causes he could be involved with that
of
are
course.
Way more important than hanging out with Joe Jackson in L.A.? Jesus. Joe Jackson's doing some kind of like press conference, and there's Reverend Al with an arm on his shoulder, basically.
I don't even
know why you're comforting this guy.
This guy doesn't give a shit. Consoling him? He's already saying, well, the legacy will continue. Yeah, no shit. Joe Jackson's going to be pumping out all kinds of fucking tapes and everything else.
Well, he announced a new record label.
Oh, did he?
Joe Jackson's like, and the name of the new record label is, and it was some weird name I don't even remember anymore. But
my son hated me, and I'm out of the will, and I need to make money records?
Right, probably.
That's a very long name for a record.
It really
company.
Is. It could probably not even fit on the record.
Probably beat them till they sing right productions. Let me tell you something.
Scare the shit out of them through an open window.
Joe Jackson, say what you want. He beat those motherfuckers into superstardom. If you beat your kids and came up with the Partridge Family, you shouldn't probably beat your kids. But if you beat the Jackson 5 out of it, you've got fucking golden fists.
Motherfuckers can harmonize. Oh. Let me punch him in the face a little harder.
Jesus, he sucked the kid around a little bit. I was so scared. You fucking put out Thriller. His work ethic that he taught you did something.
He beat the town right into those boys.
He really did.
Yeah. Well, here's your bullet points on the Michael Jackson thing. We're way up to date on this. Michael's mother filed for temporary custody of his three children yesterday.
Got the kids also. They granted her temporary custody.
Just for now. But yesterday's report that Debbie Rowe saying that those kids weren't Michael's, that was false. A lot of false reports coming out these days.
Oh, yeah?
I mean, it still could be possible, but it was announced that Debbie Rowe, you know, came out and said, no, those kids aren't his biologically anyway. But she didn't say that. Joe Jackson says Michael's funeral will be large and open to the public.
Of course.
It's going to be one of these
spectacle.
Things.
Make it a spectacle, because that's what you did with your family from the second they popped out of the womb. Jesus, this guy is despicable. This whole family is so fucked up,
mm-hmm.
And it doesn't end with him dropping
dead. Oh, hell no. Well, now it's good for business. I think a dead Michael Jackson is worth way more than a live one.
Yeah, no one really was feeling it anymore.
Michael's final will was drafted in 2002 and does not include his father. This is the biggie. So the father, of course, is like, well, that had to be a forgery.
Fake, of course.
Really?
He loved me.
Really? If all the reports are true, and it seems to be because they came from Michael Jackson, of course you're not in his will. He hated you.
Well, he'll make a hell of a lot of money anyway.
President of Michael Jackson's online fan club
mm-hmm.
says he thinks at least 12 fans have committed suicide since his death.
Thin that herd.
Who the fuck is killing themselves because Michael Jackson died?
Thin that herd.
Michael finished filming Top Secret Dome Project video. What's that? Is that the name of a song, Dome Project? That would be strange. Just before he died, expected to be completed in July, so we'll see that. Picture surface of Michael Jackson rehearsing in L.A. just 2 days before he died.
Yep.
Conflicting reports there. Some saying he looked great. Others said he looked really skinny, kind of out of it, and scared shitless about the upcoming tour.
Well, that's how he looked walking around.
Yeah.
You know what? You hear so much bullshit. Like, there was reports initially. Geraldo, I think, reported. He just was what he heard. He heard that he didn't hire, or maybe it wasn't Geraldo, that he didn't hire background singers, he didn't have dancers. And of course he did. So it's like amazing the bullshit that comes out.
Oh, yeah, the bullshit.
It was all there.
Yeah, obviously. There are dancers there and everything.
Yeah, they were gonna do these shows. I don't know how good they were going to be, but they were on their way.
He goes with the wet Jerry Curl, or went with the wet Jerry Curl kind of hair when he was live? Is that it? Because every other picture you see, he's got that... Cornelius wig on.
Well, there's rumors that he had no hair.
Yeah.
At the end of his life, so who knows? I mean, you know, we'll start getting the real facts soon. This is a weird one. Doctors waited 30 minutes after finding Jackson's body before calling 911. The reason they couldn't find a phone that was working in the mansion. And I'm like, come on.
Just stop.
No one has a cell phone?
That's ridiculous.
Just stop.
But that's being reported. And then some people might get their money back for the London concerts.
Why wouldn't they give them all their money back?
Some people.
How about everyone? There's no rescheduling here, unless you're really an optimist.
I don't know how they would be able to pull that one off. You buy a ticket for something that didn't happen, you don't get your money back. That's pretty fucked up. I wonder if there was some kind of weird little clause when you're buying the tickets.
Ah. Huh? Yeah, who knows? You probably got to jump through hoops to get it also, you know.
Yeah.
Send the ticket back on a 5x4 postcard.
The way it's working with those tickets is like you'll get the refund if you've purchased your ticket from like a reputable outlet.
Reputable.
Like if you just bought a ticket from some dude, like you're not getting a refund for that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Oh, well, that's pretty obvious. So.
You try to find some black gentleman outside the arena?
Yeah, excuse me. I'd like a refund, sir. Ow, you're punching me in the face.
So, you know, just because you hold the ticket doesn't mean that you're entitled to a refund.
Very good, Danny. That is, that makes sense.
And that's where we're at with Michael Jackson, but... You know, I think sometime this week they're going to be parading his body around L.A.
Yeah, there's some kind of a horse-drawn carriage thing like Lady Di had with the, you know, white carriage with the glass sides. Mm-hmm. And they'll...
A little Cinderella action.
March through. Yeah, yeah,
for Michael
course.
Jackson, who lived in Fantasyland anyway.
Yeah, yeah. He had a replica of the entrance to Disneyland at his Neverland Ranch.
And they want... I think they're going to bury him at Neverland, turn that into a Graceland, because that'll be a big moneymaker.
Is that rumor or?
Supposedly, they were like kind of checking out Neverland Ranch to see where there'd be a good spot.
Where they could plant them?
Where they could plant them.
Jesus.
Yeah. And I think Reverend Al was in L.A. because I think Reverend Al wants the body here in New York.
Oh, is that it?
To go up there in Harlem.
It's just weekend at Michael's.
Mm-hmm.
He's gonna cart him around, take him to dinner uptown.
But that Reverend Al is a joke. I don't know why people are still...
Anyone
holding on to what he has to say.
Anyone that takes this guy seriously should just be smacked in the head.
Why is it important that Reverend Al Jackson, might as well call him that.
Yeah.
Between Jesse Jackson and Joe Jackson. Why is it important for him to be out there in L.A.? I don't get it.
Yeah, to comfort the family.
I mean, because we only see Reverend Al when there's big media cases.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure he's working on shit all the time, whether it's...
Yeah. Injustice.
Whether it's useful or not, that's not up to me because I don't even know what he's working on when he's not, you know, whoring himself out about to the media.
Mm-hmm.
You got to think there's much more important stuff going on in his dumb little world.
But this is, this has traction.
Mm-hmm.
This one's it's news. He's going to be able to be in front of the cameras.
So why doesn't anyone call him out on this?
Because people are hypocrites and idiots.
Not us, because we have nothing to lose. I'm talking about like CNN, MSNBC, Fox News Channel.
Another something. Thing. I love the outpouring of love and adoration for this guy. Musically influential, of course. A huge talent, of course. There's no denying that. Especially in the mid-80s. It was no one bigger.
He made it to the 90s.
Michael. Yeah, and then into the 90s. But I mean, you know, with Thriller and shit like that, that was his fucking decade. He owned it.
Mm-hmm.
And no one's bringing up any of these sexual allegations that have pretty much been the only newsworthy thing in Michael Jackson's life the past 15 fucking years.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's because most of us were never touched by him. So, you know, to us, it's like...
I guess that's it.
To us, it's like,
yeah.
You know, I kind of like that, you know, Rock With You song. And
Yeah, that's
don't stop
nice
until you
on.
Get enough. You know.
Yeah, you listen to him. You go. I don't care.
You weren't diddled. Who gives a shit?
A few kids. Why not?
In a way, that's how it should be. I don't give a shit what these people are doing. Just entertain me.
But they're talking about him like a saint. Well, but
he's in that weird area. He was never proven guilty.
You know what?
Even though, you know, public opinion is like, Jesus, something was going on with him and those fucking kids.
Neither was OJ, but he slept with kids in his bed. There were allegations of just horrid things that this guy was doing. Kids had, like, ID'd his schlong.
Jesus juice. Remember the wine called
Jesus juice?
He
called it. Just stop already.
He was delusional, though, because I was watching a couple specials on Michael Jackson, and he went through that tough guy stage looking like a fairy.
Trying to be bad.
He was trying to be badass. And they got for the video some real gangster-looking dudes, and then Michael Jackson's in the leather, but he's already looking girly. Like, what are you trying to pull off there?
Because they're dance fighting. Look, they're not fighting, they're dance fighting.
If you got a dance fight, Michael's the guy you definitely want on your side.
Yes, yeah, Michael Jackson's the best dance fighter ever.
If fists are being thrown, fuck it, sit out, Mike.
Yeah, jaw. Something tells me he's got a glass jaw.
Literally.
Why would you dance fight when you could just punch him right in the face and knock his nose off his body? Why the fuck would you deal with that?
See, this was the earliest that where you were looking, going, "Wow, he had some work done, but at least he still looks kind of human."
Mm.
And then he just went crazy and decided, you know, could you put a cleft in my chin with a hatchet? And then I want my nose to be able to be removable.
Yeah, how the fuck do you get a cleft in your chin?
Oh,
what are they stapling something right to your bone?
They probably put some implants in his chin. It's ridiculous what this guy did.
He had to know how horrendous his plastic surgery looked.
Well, that's why he kept doing it, probably hoping that eventually it would look good.
It's going to get better?
To fix it?
Yeah.
Like that, during this video, what's wrong? All right, he's kind of Hispanic looking. He wanted to go for, you know, powder. He wanted to look like powder.
Well, he went black to Hispanic to white.
Yeah.
He was representing all races with his plastic surgery.
Yeah! This is not even a good song.
Well, this was the end of his run.
Really, really bad. What?
The song is bad. It's bad.
Who's bad?
Huge hit, though.
Yay.
Yeah,
huge hit. But it's just the whole gang thing where everybody's just tough. And it's like, I hate these fucking giant dance scenes. In subways.
Yeah, but that was the times.
Look, they're kicking ass on the other guys by dancing better.
Yeah.
They brung it.
And the other guys are like, oh, fuck, now what?
Now what? Michael Jackson's here. We're fucked.
We're fucked. He's out dancing us. We have guns, but we're not allowed to use them because this is a dance fight.
Knives, chains, whatever. They're running around doing pirouettes.
Right. Yeah, they're all black belts in karate, but oh, fuck, I can't use my skills.
And he pulls a grate off the wall, and wind hits him.
All right, enough of bad. Who gives a shit?
Because he's bad.
That's a terrible video. Who enjoys? Someone's watching that and having fun with it, and I can't comprehend it. It's horrible.
We didn't know any better. When that video was out, that's all we had. That's the problem.
Well, the guy was also the pioneer of that long-form video. Mm-hmm. Like everyone before that was doing, you know, the quick, cheesy, regular video thing, and then he brings in, you know, John Landis to direct. It's on film. It's fucking, you know, an epic.
He fucked up.
No one was doing that shit.
He fucked up Pat Benatar and the rest of them.
Oh, all of them just looked and went, well, there's the bar
now. Oh, great. Thanks.
Now we're setting the bar that fucking
high.
Yeah,
now we got to hang with Hollywood directors because of you. Thanks.
We were good with a camera covered with tinfoil spinning around in the middle going, and I ran.
Yeah,
and now I got to make an 18-minute feature film.
Yeah, they used to just find their nephew that was in film school in college. Yeah. Hey, can you film more video?
Got a camera?
Then stupid Michael Jackson gets John Landis.
John Landis.
Jesus Christ.
Fucking directing it.
And the video cost millions of dollars.
Oh, yeah.
The rest of them, you know, maybe 10 grand, 20 grand.
Yeah, we could get you on MTV, $10,000 to do this. Thriller's like an epic.
That video stinks.
What, Thriller?
Ugh.
But
once again, for the time, it was pretty amazing.
You watched it when it was on, right?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And by the way, that bad video was directed by Martin Scorsese.
Was it really?
That was Scorsese?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, well,
look like Scorsese.
How about fucking maybe if De Niro and Pesci came in and punched Michael's nose off? That would make me happy.
I couldn't read.
He had Landis and Scorsese. Jesus. Oh my God.
That is something, huh?
Here's the story on the child. So you got a plane that crashes in the Indian Ocean. Everyone's dead except for a toddler.
Yemen Airlines Airbus A310 crashed in the Indian Ocean just north of the island of Comoros. According to the Associated Press, this aircraft carrying more than 150 people has landed in a wide open area there. But there had been rescue aircraft up, boats in the area, and incredibly, a toddler has been pulled alive from the ocean. Yemenia's flight 626 was flying from Yemen's capital of Sana'a to the Comoros. The president of the Comoros also says bodies and wreckage have been spotted in the water during a flyover. It's the second crash of an Airbus jet this month. On June the 1st, Air France flight 447 crashed off of Brazil, carrying 228 people, all of those people presumed dead. And, of course, we're going to keep you updated on this story throughout the morning. We're going to bring up a pilot, by the way, who has flown Airbus planes ahead this hour to talk to us about what might have potentially happened to that aircraft.
Yeah, and there were some questions that we were looking into of whether or not those sensors that tell the plane how fast they're going and how fast the airspeed needs to be when they're in the air, if those are malfunctioning in any way, shape, or form in some of these incidents.
It has been a repeated problem on some Airbus aircraft over the last few months, actually going all the way back to last year.
It's just amazing that a toddler pulled alive from
it's
that wreckage.
It's pretty incredible. It really is.
A repeated problem? I call it more than a repeated problem with these things going down.
I'll take a Boeing 767, 777 any day.
Dude, how often do 747s go down? Almost never.
They usually either terrorists have brought them down. What was that? Canary Islands collision on the runway. But it's, and then that fuel problem in the wing with the Flight 800. But other than that, these freaking Airbuses, I don't know.
They're all so old.
I don't like those.
Because they're all the plane crashes over there. Because I think we sell a lot of our planes to other countries when we're done with them, right?
Here, Yemen, take this. Airbus, those aren't all that old. I mean, I just don't like that friggin' carbon fiber tail on those things. They tell the guy you can't snap the rudder over too hard in the wind or that your tail comes off. That's like a nice feature.
Yeah. No, I don't think they're. I think the 747 and stuff are older than they are.
Oh, yeah, they are, definitely.
I don't fucking trust anything with an Airbus. The name of it just annoys me. I don't
Airbus.
Trust it.
Airbus.
Yeah, you don't want to go I don't trust it. Called the Airbus. No, that's scary because a bus like should those. Be on the ground, yeah. Not in the air. Hence, that's, Airbus name stinks.
JetBlue uses only Airbus aircraft, which, you know. I like JetBlue and everything, but...
All right. Enough with JetBlue. I'm flying Friday on JetBlue.
Oh, Jesus. Are you?
Yeah. Yeah, thanks.
Good luck, bro.
Fun fact, Michael used real Crips and Bloods for the background gang for Bad, bringing two rival gangs together. Thank you, guys, Tony in Connecticut.
Making the peace.
Is that possible, you think?
No.
Huh? No. Or maybe it was old gang members that are rehabilitated and said, all right, what the fuck, we'll do this and make us... Make a little stand for
there was
Michael.
One guy.
One guy from each.
Yeah.
That happened to be brothers anyway.
And they kept him way in the back so they couldn't see each other.
And who was the lead member of the other gang that Michael Jackson was fighting?
Samuel L. Jackson.
Oh, wow. No. Chad in Ohio.
Who cares?
Yeah, man.
I thought that's who the gang member was. Chad in Ohio.
Hey, Chad.
Yeah, I watched that Bad video for the first time the other day, and it was Wesley Snipes.
Wesley Snipes was in the rival gang?
I'm telling you, watch the video. It's Wesley Snipes.
Wow.
Is it a young Wesley Snipes?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to have to go back to the Bad video, I guess. Thank you, sir.
That.
All right, punch it up.
All right. Mike in Massachusetts. Mike?
Good morning, boys.
Hey, man.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, this is what happens once the economy goes to shit. The friggin' bigwigs don't want to open their wallet up, so they fix their planes up right. Instead, they lay off all their mechanics, and look at everything's going to shit.
Well, that is true. The airlines, when they're taking a hit, the economy's bad, the price of fuel, things like that. You got to know they got a few less screw turners in
they're
the
not tuning up the
in
planes.
The hangars.
Oh,
yeah.
Boy.
Yeah, the system gets a little shoddier and shoddier day by day, you know? But all right, boys, stepping out.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Like those little video games where you got to keep up maintenance on things, and then sometimes when you realize you're going broke, you go, all right, I got to cut back on things. Yeah. And you cut back on that maintenance and things. Yeah.
And then the panic sets in.
And then the roller coaster flies off the track because you didn't you didn't maintain it enough. Other people are grumbling because there's garbage on the sidewalk. I love those games.
But they don't speak English, though.
That's
so
that roller coaster
shit?
Sim. They're all mad. All right, I'll put a bathroom here. Stop it. There's people peeing their pants because you forgot to put bathrooms up. I'm the worst at those games. I just get all angry at the people that are angry and chase them out of the park.
Well, that's the only way to play those games.
Roller Coaster Tycoon. This is a Roller Coaster Tycoon Massacre. People do have fun with these. They build roller coasters that have no way of surviving them. Look at all the people walking up. This guy made a very nice roller coaster, apparently. It goes straight up. Wow, at a very high rate of speed. Mm-hmm. And then apparently, is there a top there? Yeah. Does it go down? All right, it goes over the top. Oh, that's a nice... Wow, is that a high roller coaster? Whoa, now it's going down.
Oh, I would hate that.
Loop. All right, nice big bank turn. Oh, no, this ain't going to be good. Oh, no, is it go?
Jesus. And it comes off the track and kills all of the people on line.
And hits the line. Oh, is that fantastic?
Fail.
And then explodes.
That's awesome.
That's the guy had it loop around right into the line of people waiting to get on the roller coaster.
That's the only way to play those games.
Yeah.
Why play it right?
There's so much stress with those games. You're just trying to – it's spinning plates. Mm-hmm. That's what it is. It's the spinning plates game. Everything's breaking and you got to fix them. But, again, back to the whole aircraft thing. It's the same thing. You cut back on certain things and other things don't work out so well.
True. Before we move on from the Michael Jackson thing, yeah, here's...
I move on.
Here's Joe Jackson from yesterday, talking about setting up the new record company.
Do you know anything, Mr. Jackson, about funeral arrangements? Have you had time to...
Yeah, we haven't gotten to that yet. Yeah, but we're working on that. Yeah. This is my shit.
He ain't working on shit, by the way.
But we're working on that.
He ain't working on shit, this guy. He loves just being in the public eye as Michael Jackson's father.
And getting a boatload of cash.
I've never seen less grief in my life than with this Joe Jackson guy.
Yeah.
Janet Jackson sort of showed some grief on the BET Awards. But it sounds like she hasn't had a relationship with Michael Jackson in so long. That's why she said, you know, we all miss him, meaning we haven't really hung out with him in years.
Yeah.
Was it kind of – I didn't see the BET Awards. Was it kind of like just like a – All right, that's what you kind of have to say. It didn't seem sincere.
She seemed pretty sincere, but she also seemed like she really hasn't had any type of relationship with her own brother for a long time. And that's, I think, what she was referencing more than his death. When she said, we miss him.
This is my show.
Thank you. How is, you said your wife is, what about Janet and the rest of the family, the daughters and everything?
They're all doing fine. But I want to make this statement. This is a real good statement here. Marshall and I... We own the record company called
Ranch Records.
Right.
Okay, it's driven by Blu-ray technology. Yeah. And that's his next step.
And that's your next step. There had been talk to us about
this.
That's what they're talking about?
Fucking scumbag.
Yeah. And this is who Reverend Al needs to hang out with.
He just, his kid isn't even fucking in the ground.
No.
They haven't even done the second autopsy on him.
No.
And he's promoting a new fucking record label.
Yep.
And it's obviously this guy could give a flying fuck about his kid.
Yep. He just wants to make sure the money keeps rolling in.
I thought I plugged it inappropriate times.
Wow.
Jesus Christ. I don't have a kid being buried.
And yeah, he's promoting the new record company.
New record company,
That's
please.
That's way more important.
Let me keep making money off of this fucking kid's corpse.
Right.
Unbelievable. Yeah. What a scumbag.
And Reverend Al, I'm going to say it all morning,
is
standing right there. And the media continues to take this guy seriously.
Is anyone calling out anyone on this?
No.
What the fuck is the news doing?
No.
Tributes all over the fucking place. Oh, my God. Show how fucked up this family was.
I feel kind of sorry for Michael Jackson after hearing that. No wonder the guy was so fucked up.
He was saying in some interview, somebody, I didn't see the interview, somebody was relating what he said, that he said he was so scared of his father, he would vomit on himself when his father, sometime when he would see his father, would just throw up. Apparently, he was terrified of his father.
Wow.
Yeah.
Somebody was telling a story on CNN over the weekend, I think, and during his last child molestation, you know, case, Michael Jackson had to go to the bathroom, and, you know, they kind of stopped everyone from going to the bathroom, right? And this one reporter happened to be in there already, so he's actually taking a leak, you know, side by side with Michael and just kind of having small chat, no big deal, right?
Yeah.
They're both done with their business. Michael leaves, and this guy leaves that, you know, retold the story. And the first person waiting online to get into the bathroom was Michael Jackson's father.
Really?
They even told, you know, the father, no, fuck, you know, Michael's in there, you know, you have to wait.
Wow.
You have to wait. That's what kind of relationship they had.
No wonder he butchered himself. He probably wanted to look nothing like his father.
Yeah. God, look at that.
Oh, that's the most bizarre photo right
What's
there.
What's that? It's a shot. It looks like he's in court there. It's like he's scratching his left eye.
And it fell off.
But he looks like Japanimation almost with his eyes open really wide. Yeah. It's fucking creepy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they did something where they actually clipped his friggin' eyelids, it looks like. I don't know what they did. They pinned him up.
Yeah, those eyes are...
Look at that nose, though. There is so
Why
much...
Why couldn't they figure out the fucking nose for him? You would think that would be easy. They've been doing nose jobs forever.
Yeah, but...
But they shaved that bone down way too much.
They did too much on that one.
I bet you it was for sound, too, though. I bet you he wanted his voice to... He was afraid of his voice deepening, because, you know, his voice was still pretty high,
mm-hmm.
that he probably wanted to have that kind of nasal twang to it.
There's a tribute channel on SiriusXM I've kind of had on in the background the last few days. Michael Jackson had a... creepy singing style. What's that one song? Human. It was a big hit for
Human
him.
Nature.
Human Nature. Can we hear a little of that? He's so breathy, and it's creepy to listen to.
Yeah.
And that, I remember that was a huge freaking song for him. Listen, just how breathy he gets.
That is so creepy, you're right.
I didn't realize how creepy it was, but when you just listen to the vocal part.
Sing it better, motherfucker! What are you doing, you son of a bitch? Not so breathy, motherfucker!
You think he had a good voice? For real.
On certain songs, not this one.
Not this one, right? But this was a big hit for him.
Yeah.
Was it?
Yeah. Yeah.
This is a big hit.
Yeah.
I can honestly say I don't even think I remember this one.
Yeah. He had a good voice, but I think that he was overrated in a way because he was Michael. Like, I never liked the Jackson 5 because I couldn't hear a little boy singing about adult relationships.
But his voice back then was...
Uncle Paul.
But, I mean, it was amazing. But I just...
His voice back then was amazing, though. How he could sing. It was like, holy shit.
Amazing. It just doesn't resonate
with me.
Coming
from a deep place. But then, I don't know. It's also amazing that this is the same guy we're listening to right now.
Why? But at least he had a good voice.
Let's say hi to Chuck in Indiana. Chuck.
Hey, what's up, boys?
Hey.
Hey, man.
What's up, little Jimmy?
Hey, buddy.
Hey, when Michael was like 4 years old, Joe Jackson used to hit him with a cattle prod. And he used to go, hee hee. Punching out, guy.
Oh, that's the other thing I noticed listening to the tribute channel. Oh, my. I can't even count how many songs he did that. And many different versions of that.
Yeah. Which was terrible, by the way.
That was like his catchphrase as he sang back back then. People loved hearing that.
Let's go to Woody in Kentucky. Woody.
Hey. Morning, guys.
Hi, Woody.
Hey, Woody.
Everybody talked about seeing the moonwalk for the first time, but I haven't heard anybody talk about jacking off to that one with Lisa Marie. That video he did with her was pretty good.
For what song?
God, I can't remember the name of it. They show it on, it was like early 90s kind of thing, and she's nude, and they kind of zoom in on her ass.
Oh, yeah.
I never thought she was fucking hot.
But you got to be careful and time it out. You'll fucking be blowing your load to him.
You didn't think Lisa Marie Presley was
no,
hot?
No.
She had really nice eyes.
She looked like Elvis.
Really nice
eyes. Her
eyes
looked like Elvis. She looked like fucking Elvis.
All right, then I liked Elvis's eyes then. What can I tell you? No, I thought she had really nice eyes.
Yeah.
Her daughter is smoking. You see pictures of Lisa Marie Presley's daughter yet?
No.
I think she's a model.
Really? How old is she?
Woody.
How old is she?
She's right around that model age.
She's like 10?
12?
No. She's anywhere from 15 to 21, somewhere in there. Hmm. I know that's a big gap. I don't know for sure how old.
She's got a big gap? What?
Yeah, big gap.
What?
Well, we got the news story on Madoff, too, which is the big news. I don't know what we're supposed to do with the Madoff fucking thing. Justice is being served, obviously. Yeah. Let's see if there's anything else in this.
For Bernie Madoff, it was payback time. 150 years for billions robbed and lives ruined.
Madoff made my life a hell, and I hope his life and his family's are now a hell.
In federal court, victims spewed at the Ponzi schemer as Madoff stared straight at...
Let me ask you something. That's a very interesting statement. How long did he get away with this? Mm. And would you take that contract? Because he's what, 60?
He's 71.
71, okay.
Probably 30 years, 35 years.
Yeah.
So would you... I would take that contract. 30 years of amazing wealth.
30 years.
Say
it's like 30 making
years
a deal
from,
with the devil.
Say 30 years from right now.
It is. It's like making a deal with the devil.
And then you're in your 70s and they finally catch you. Would you take that deal? But you have amazing wealth for the next 30 years. Could go wherever the fuck you want. Buy whatever the fuck you want. Fuck whatever you want.
That's pretty good.
I would so take that deal.
That's a pretty good deal. But then you got to be in prison when you're done.
71. What else is there to do?
You know what it
he's
is?
He's just short of like starting to get old. You know what I mean? In
you'd
5 years, it won't make any.
You'd be 70, though, at some point, just going, oh, man.
Well.
This sucks.
Like they said he's like going for massages and stuff like that. Like he would walk. His secretary said he would leave the office and go out for his daily. Like he enjoyed living the life.
He had everything. Yeah. Would you take that contract? I think I would take that contract. That's why when that victim said, "I hope he suffers like we did," I'm like, I think it's too late, really.
Yeah, he already.
I mean, he's got the big fall, but I mean, it's not like he's still a younger guy. He's up there.
But the thing
is, his golf game is probably suffering. His hard-ons aren't as hard anymore. You know what I mean? So I was like, ah.
He's got them droopy ones.
Right.
I don't know. Because, you know, you're at that point.
He's not going to suffer.
And you got to be in prison? Yeah.
You know, another year from now, whatever.
And he knows what
he'll
it's like to live
go,
large.
He'll look back and go, God damn, I had a fucking fun 30-some-odd years.
But he knows
fucking
what
over
that's
everybody.
Like.
Yeah.
To live well.
I don't think you really suffer that much in prison in the end.
I don't know. You remember the worst part?
I really don't.
Worst part about being off the air it being gone. Remember it was like you had the money. It wasn't like the money. It was just that fucking thing that was lacking because you knew what it was like to have it.
Yeah, you know what? It's probably a relief for him too because throughout that whole 30 plus years, he's like, when the fuck am I going to get caught and why haven't I been caught yet?
They got to catch on soon.
And that's got to like play heavy on your heart.
The first inkling that they were catching on, he must have been, oh, here it comes. Here it comes.
I would have just like taken a jet and just
go somewhere.
Yeah.
Somewhere, a little island somewhere with all your money.
And just hope for the best.
Spewed at the Ponzi schemer as Madoff stared straight ahead. They called him a psychopath, a beast, and an evil lowlife. When Madoff got up to speak, one left the courtroom. Madoff partially turned to his victims and said, I'm sorry, I know that doesn't help you. Then it was Judge Denny Chin's turn. He called Madoff extraordinarily evil and gave him the max, 150 years. Madoff didn't even flinch.
Well, no. He knew it was coming for a really long time.
Flinch.
Ow!
Right.
You go like, yeah! 100,000!
You should get the death penalty. Then he would suffer.
Just make you suffer.
How did? Let me ask you a question. How is the SEC not responsible for paying some of these people back? They were warned 10 years ago
about
that it was
guy,
a Ponzi scheme.
Yep.
And I think they were afraid of him because he used to be the head of the NASDAQ. People were scared of this guy. How is the government on some level, when they were their job is to protect you, this is what we fucking pay them for,
yeah.
And they were warned and they wouldn't investigate him, or they didn't and people who looked at him saw what he was doing.
No, he was the face of it. He was the guy. So they were able to just say, yeah, this is the guy to blame, not us.
I
agree, though. You know, the SEC, is, especially if they were warned about this guy, should have saved people billions.
Well, you know how they're making you return any profits. You have to give back profits because he's doing an illegal Ponzi scheme.
Yeah.
So I want to know, is the IRS going to give back the money that people paid them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, if I profited illegally, not even knowing it, I might have to turn my profits over to the government. So the IRS must have to give back my profits too, right, to me?
Probably not.
No?
Yeah.
How's that work?
Isn't that amazing? Yeah.
Amazing. Danny, what's up?
Nice one-sided.
Boys, don't forget, he's going to federal prison. That place is a country club. My old man was there. He said it's a joke.
Why was your old man in federal prison?
Oh, man, he was a bad man. He wasn't a bad man. He was just running a bunch of drugs down in Miami.
Then he was a bad man.
Right. Well, all right, but what did your dad say about federal prison?
Oh, man, they'd have a buffet. They'd ride bikes around the compound. It was just, he had a TV in his room, had his own room. I did a little time in Florida, and it was a state jail. And over there, you have to share a room with somebody else. You don't have a TV. It's horrible. In federal prison, it's like a hotel living.
Now, I wonder, Bernie Madoff, I wonder if he made some kind of a deal knowing what he knows. You know what I mean? Like, they sat him down and go, look, you're fucked. You're fucked, and I know
a
you know.
Horrible deal that he get for 150 years.
Federal prison instead of hard time, something like that is what I'm thinking. Because why isn't he talking out? It seems like he knows other people. It seems like it's, you know what I mean. It's a club down there. What he was involved
with. He actually said he was the only one involved in this.
That's what makes
that's
me very
the public,
suspicious.
You know, statement that.
And I'm just wondering if they go, look, no matter what, you're fucked. There's nothing we can do for you. But if you keep your fucking mouth shut, we'll at least get you in federal prison where it's a little easier than going to Rikers or whatnot. Something doesn't sound right. How could he be the only guy?
Yeah, that's a pretty big
operation. How could he be the only one? He's not hanging out with guys on golf courses and stuff and going on vacations. And you know what I mean? It's like a little
club.
Yeah, you
got this great money-making thing. You want in?
They said, look, you're taking the hit for all of us. But we'll make sure, you know, your time is the best we could make it.
His wife's getting to keep $2.5 million, too, which she should probably be allowed to keep fucking $50,000 and then go. She should be able to keep none of that shit. What? Maybe that was part of the deal.
Why are they saying she gets
$2.5 million? I don't know how they're working that out. I don't know if she knew what he was doing or not. Who the fuck knows if the wife knows what the husband's business is? She may just know he's a...
What did she do that she deserves $2.5 million?
Nothing.
Hit the streets.
Hit the bricks, honey.
That's right.
Yeah, she should be able to keep none of it.
All right. Billy Mays. We're going to talk about him next.
Billy Mays.
We got the 911 call. Nice.
Really?
Yes, we do. And another 911 call, which is just terrific.
Uh-oh.
So two 911 calls on the way.
Ooh.
And Sam went down to the Gay Pride Day yesterday. Gay Pride Parade.
It was on Sunday. It was Pride Weekend, actually, but the parade here in the city was on Sunday.
Not for work, right? Just to hang out down there. Yeah.
What parade was he at then? Yesterday?
None.
So this is from Sunday?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's gay pride.
Sam talked to the geese, and he did a little What's the Haps.
What's the Haps.
So we'll do that after the break as well.
A lot of flamboyant gay people down there at that
We're
parade.
We're going to find out.
Down there. I was in the city on Sunday up here.
It's everywhere.
And they were all over the place. Unbelievable. Yeah. Just like walking down 57th Street, just, you know, very flamboyant, sparkly shorts and
ooh,
and just extreme, like, you know, a lot of people holding hands and just being very, very flamboyantly
gay. Being very gay in public.
Now, have we talked to, like, the gay community in general? Like, that's like, I can't imagine they want that type of gay representing everybody in their community, right?
It's the one that makes the news.
Yeah, but what is the gay community? Aren't they trying to tell these people, will you calm the fuck down? We're trying to get some shit done. You can't walk the streets and you know, this shit and fucking do what you're doing.
That is the ammunition for the conservatives. Right. When they just go, right, look at this video, right. And there's some fucking guy dressed like Cher sucking some other guy's dick on a float.
Instead of two, you know, normal guys in business suits, yeah, trying to, like,
yeah, we're just trying to get married,
right? Get married and
raise, I love Pete.
Raise their right, <Yeah. laughs> and try to raise their gay family. Instead, it's the flamboyant shit that makes the news. You would think that they would sit down as a community and go, "Look, knock enough it. With the flamboyant knock shit. It. You're killing us."
Exactly. Can you imagine if like Jewish people had like a Jewish day parade?
It was all just Hasidic
Jews,
Hasidic Jews
chasing money through the streets.
Every stereotype. Yeah, like Borat.
Right, exactly. The running of the Jews.
Yeah, it's just every bad stereotype.
Look, Fred, could you leave your peacock, uniform or costume at home, please? We're trying to get some things done. We're trying to legalize marriage in all 50 states.
Trying for equality and acceptance.
You and your peacock ass-showing fucking costume isn't helping the cause.
Expressing yourself doesn't mean showing your genitals on Fifth Avenue.
Right. Can you please not show your genitals on Fifth Avenue?
Look at this guy.
That's all we ask.
Yes. Looking at a guy on some rollerblades.
What does the gay community do about this?
Pretty much nude.
Like, this isn't a... I can't imagine that they're looking at this as like, yeah, this is a celebration for us.
But it's a complete celebration of nothing but sexuality.
Right.
And you know, if you did a straight parade like this, it would be hysterical. Just guys going around fucking women, dicks hanging out.
Right.
Here's where I love putting this in a vagina.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to show you here on this float.
But don't take your like. Don't have a parade where you showcase every sexual aspect and then wonder why people are nervous about having you.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Teach and look at these guys. I mean,
come on,
there are a bunch of muscle men walking around in jockey shorts.
Is this from this weekend?
I don't know. I'm not sure about that.
But it's like, why do you have to wear jockey shorts? All right, you're all well-built guys. Why can't you just wear fucking jeans or regular jean shorts?
Because the cock is so much easier to get out in jockeys.
But why do you need to highlight the cock? Like, straight guys, we like our cocks, too. It's like everyone likes their own cocks. Why do you have to... how about we have a straight parade where women's cunt lips are highlighted? Look at that. Isn't that lovely? A
nice,
giant
beautiful.
Cake.
Gary, could you leave your banana hammock home? We're trying to get marriage legalized in Indiana.
We're really trying to have people look at us in a different way.
I
there's
can't
three
these
guys
that Danny is finding is going to help the cause.
They're dressed in sailor hats with the blue, like what the sailors wear around their neck,
but no
shirt or pants.
No.
And what they are wearing jock straps.
Calvin Klein, the tiny Calvin Klein, you know, underpants.
Those are jocks.
And then boots.
I'm not putting anything crazy into the search, field either.
No.
It, just gay parade. And you'll find all these pictures.
That's all it takes.
All you
unbelievable.
Do.
You think somebody would sit them down and go, look, could you and Phil, like, we're trying to get something done here. Could you not hump each other on the float?
Right.
They don't do that at the Columbus Day Parade. They don't do that at the Puerto Rican. They don't do that at the Columbus Parade.
Look at the young Rich Voss having a good time.
Oh, God. Yeah, there's a guy with boss hair.
From his crack days.
Guy.
His long, curly hair that we've seen on Voss.
Jesus.
Yeah, I don't. We'll have to ask Sam if maybe they toned it down because
they bring the squeegee team in after.
Jeez, hoses,
just squeegee thing, squeegeeing stuff into the sewers. Wow! Oh yeah, there you go. That's what you need—a big black guy in a loincloth with bones around his neck. That's wonderful.
All right, we'll take a break. We'll do what's the haps at the Gay Pride Parade. Sam did that for us.
Ooh.
And we'll talk about Billy Mays.
Yes.
I guess we know how he died now. Wow.
Yes, the autopsy is through.
Already?
Yeah.
All right, we'll tell you next. Opie and Anthony. Opie and Anthony. There's a great craze going on the internet the last few days. George Clooney is the latest victim. The fake celebrity death craze.
Yeah.
It fucking rules. There was a Britney Spears one yesterday. There's a George Clooney one today. Jeff Goldblum.
Jeff Goldblum was like the first fake one. And because so many celebrities have been dying, No one really believed Billy Mays was dead because everyone thought it was a goof.
And Rick Astley, right?
Rick Astley is...
Astley. He's the number one Google trend, Rick Astley dead.
Come on.
I love it.
Oh, he's not dead.
We should start one on our show.
Yeah.
Maybe a mayor or something.
No.
That's crazy.
Yeah, we started the whole thing years ago.
Oh,
hoo,
yeah.
Hoo-hoo.
Hoo-hoo to us.
Yes.
Is Hoo-hoo working this week? Does anyone know?
Vacation.
Huh?
He's on vacation.
God damn, that's got to be something.
Are you kidding me?
That has to be something.
So how long is he on vacation for?
Is he on vacation? Yeah, all week.
All week?
Definitely.
He'll be back next week?
Shit.
I don't know.
It's just astounding. I'm not even gonna fucking criticize him. I'm not even gonna go because if you could get away with that fucking deal, God bless you. But who the fuck?
Yeah, when it's our turn for that deal, they're like, see, it didn't work the first time we did it, so we can't ever do that again.
I had phone calls yesterday, all kinds of shit. All kinds of stuff. And it's just weeks of being off.
We've been in this building since early April, so almost 3 months, I guess, May, June. Let's call it almost 3 months. I think we haven't even taken a week off yet.
No.
Because we took a week off before we moved over here.
Yeah.
So officially, we haven't taken a week since we started here 3 months ago. And it's safe to say...
Probably.
It's safe to say, counting this week... Wow.
And counting all the Fridays, too.
Well, it's mind-boggling how many days he's had off since we moved into this building. Are we jealous? Abso-fucking-lutely.
Oh, yes.
I'm not even going to front. Abso-fucking-lutely. But I don't know how that could possibly be good for a company, but who am I to say?
Wow.
He's on vacation until July 12th?
The 12th?
Get the fuck out of here. And we're taking Friday off so we could have a long weekend. And the guilt these fuckers down the hall give us over that one.
Oh, my God. Forget about
it. I'm scared because I actually have to leave maybe an hour early on Thursday to catch a flight. I don't even know how I present that to the bosses. I don't even know how
Good
I get
luck.
That done.
You know what you do? We start a small fire, and then we all just run out for the drill and don't come back.
Right. Yeah, that could work.
We are three Michael Jacksons, and there's a bunch of Joe Jacksons down the hall scaring the fucking shit out of us.
Scaring us.
Just imagine that. It's July 4th weekend. We have Friday off. We were able to pull that off. I need to get out of here a little early Thursday, and I'm too scared to tell him that.
Yeah.
And this guy is off till July 12th?
Yeah. Wow, is that... And unbelievable.
And he gets the whole month of August off. So he's coming back for 2 weeks to go away for another month?
And no Fridays.
And no Fridays on top of that.
I don't know what to say anymore. I don't even know what to say anymore.
And there's no one here, by the way. We're the only people that show up every day. Look down the hall.
Well.
No one's even here yet.
No, I know. Yeah, there's nothing. The place is deserted.
Well, he comes back July 12th.
God, that's something. What a deal.
Oh, and the shit they're pulling with us, it's just amazing. Oh, my God.
Amazing is a very nice way to put it.
It's amazing.
You're being very diplomatic.
It's amazing. The stuff we can't even talk about.
I was stammering on the phone yesterday during, you know, my explanation of my personal day that I took. With Steve Blatter, I was on the phone like going, this is why I had to explain my July 12th.
Well, the good news, this is Nick in New Mexico, and this is why it doesn't work. By the way, I'm sorry, but someone has to say it. It doesn't work when your quote main guy takes that much time off. I don't know how that works for a company. Go ahead, Nick.
Yeah, how you doing, guys?
Hey,
no, it doesn't work at all because he's so irrelevant that when his well-informed listeners finally hear about Farrah Fawcett and Michael Jackson, it'll be July 13th or 12th.
Yeah, great timing on his part. the pop culture world is in a tizzy right now.
Yeah.
And I know the break because he's done it a million times. Well, everybody wants me to comment on Michael Jackson's death. Everybody's been talking to me, and they want me to comment on Michael Jackson's death. Dude. Well, here goes. You know, back in the early 90s, Michael Jackson wanted to sit down with me to reinvent his career.
Oh, right.
Really? Do you have a picture of that meeting? Because I don't believe that. It.
And he came in and his nose fell off.
Right. And I decided that that would not be good for me, so I passed on that. But everyone,
his face was melted.
Everyone wants me to comment on the Michael Jackson thing. He's done that break a million fucking times. Like, yeah, the whole world doesn't know what to do with themselves until Howard comments on the Michael Jackson situation. You know, I was out there in the Hamptons, and everybody said, man, what are you thinking about the Michael Jackson thing?
I said, shut up. I got to watch the polo game.
Everybody. It's always everybody. Yeah, okay. Everybody was getting a hold of me. They wanted to know about Farrah Fawcett.
Everybody? Everybody.
Everybody.
Everyone!
I guess I... Or you could...
scene.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I guess I got a comment.
That was it.
I guess I got a comment on the Michael Jackson situation. Do you? Really?
Yeah.
How about you just talk about it like a human being? Jesus. July 12th? That just stopped the radio show.
I know. Really.
And we're taking a lousy day off for the 4th of July weekend.
And there's
the fucking workhorses.
And there's grumblings.
Right. Yeah. I think I'm going to be injected with my hormones down the hall so my voice doesn't change. Thank you, Joe Jackson, for the opportunity. Thank you.
Unbelievable.
Oh, God. Get out of here.
What?
Hey, Eric.
Does he really think that?
Yeah.
That is the dumbest thing we could do.
Look, that entered my brain, and then I said, look, I'm not even going to vocalize that.
Yeah.
Erock's a nice fat kid with no instincts.
Not except to eat. It's instinctual.
People yelling red.
Sorry, Eric.
People yelling red flag. It's like, no, this is what's going on. That's crazy.
No, that was a red flag.
Oh, yeah, and we red flagged ourselves.
But this is fine.
So wait, he comes back July 12th and then goes back. I think his deal is he gets every August off now. Yeah. So what, he comes back for, oh, he gives us 2 weeks. Thank you. Everybody. I couldn't even walk around with someone going, but Howard, what do you think of the Michael Jackson thing?
I mean, I met the guy.
And then Farrah Fawcett, I don't know.
Yeah.
But the workhorses are here once again today. Jesus. And then they give us crap about stuff we can't even mention on the air. When we finally tell you what is going on, you guys are going to be stupefied. Holy shit.
Yellow flag.
I know.
We need a yellow. We need a triple thing.
But they can't.
Like a triangle. Yeah. Red, green, but then a yellow. Yellow flag is the corner.
Everybody. Because I'm the greatest thing ever. Billy Mays is dead. Everyone was thinking that. Everyone was thinking that it was a little bump on the head because of a little fucking turbulence, right?
How did your shill die?
That's terrible. I smell clean.
Ah, that poor guy. Look at him. Thumbs up. Happy as a pig in shit.
Yeah.
And
he should put one of those thumbs in the hole in his heart.
Oh.
Jesus.
Oh, some of the blockage.
Well, what?
Clear some of the blockage out with the thumb.
Or maybe he had too much of that putty in his fucking veins there, Danny, the one you liked.
Mighty putty?
Mighty yeah. putty. Maybe, that's what it was. He was
maybe
eating
too much,
mighty putty.
Too much mighty putty in his system.
He had to clear out his aorta with an awesome auger.
Oh, yeah, shit.
I guess we gave it away, but it turns out the fucking guy had heart disease and that bump on the head was just a major coincidence.
Nothing. Yeah. That was nothing.
Little turbulence. He gets hit on the head because some luggage fell or something fell from above.
Yeah, and then he dies.
And then he twitters that he got a little bump on his head. He goes to bed, never wakes up.
What about the ShamWow guy? Did he die too or no?
No, he just got fucked a hooker and beat her up.
And he got the shit beat out of him by a hooker.
Anthony, by the way, someone has a calendar. They said, no, we were wrong. He actually comes back on the 13th because the 12th is a Sunday.
Okay.
So add another day to that.
Add an extra day. That's fine.
By the time he comes back, we will do another 10 to 11 original shows for everybody.
God damn.
But they, oh, my God. I can't.
Is that the ShamWow hooker?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. They're both just the gun. That must have been a hell of a session.
Oh, yeah.
I'm looking at hospital pictures. They both have the shit beat out of
Would
them.
Would you take that deal?
What?
Well, I mean, you're going to end up like that. But like you said, it must have been a hell of a deal.
Must
that
have been fucked up.
That must have been a hell of a fucking session, is like you're saying.
Is that her down at the bottom? Mm-hmm. Let me see her there.
What the fuck happened there? That's bizarre.
Wow. She looked, without those giant black eyes and red fucking red eyes, she probably wasn't that bad looking.
I saw, maybe I could find it again. I saw yesterday, I pulled up her mugshot from like 2004.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, she's not that bad.
Not that bad?
Nah.
What's he saying happened? Did he say, did she want more money? Did she not want to? A lot of these girls don't want to fuck. They want to show up. You're paying for my time, and then they want to charge you more when they get
there. From what I remember, I might have it wrong, but I think he wanted to kiss her, and she didn't want to kiss.
Oh.
And he kept like just trying to stick his tongue in her mouth or something, and I think she actually bit it, and that's why
she tried to bite it right off.
That's why there's blood all over his cheeks and stuff.
Yeah, that's
his chin because it was like his blood in the mouth.
Yeah, his tongue's fucked up. So, we got the Billy Mays 911 call, but it turns out he died of heart disease. Did he have a heart attack? He must have had a heart
attack.
That's
the same. While he was sleeping, he went to bed. He wasn't feeling good, and that's it.
What Billy a great
Mays
way to go out!
Doesn't wake up.
Hypertensive heart disease. What is hypertensive heart disease?
High blood pressure and then
high blood pressure and a little blockage, maybe
blockage.
A little combo, platter with the heart.
That's it. Yeah, she's not that bad. The ShamWow hooker girl.
When she's cleaned up, she looks pretty good.
Cleans up nice when she doesn't have black eyes.
Oh, who the fuck does she look like?
The hooker that the ShamWow guy.
There's a little.
Something in there. I know. The picture on the right, you're thinking, right?
A little Kate Hudson on the right, slightly, and a little...
what's her name?
Scarlett Johansson on the left.
Little Mackenzie Phillips, circa 1981.
She looks like somebody. It's whatever.
Like one of the Tilly sisters as a younger on the left, a little bit.
Rebecca De Mornay.
There you go. That's exactly who it is.
Maybe.
Rebecca De Mornay.
Here's the Billy Mays 911 call.
Could you send an ambulance? Billy Mays here needs some emergency services.
Tampa Fire Rescue, what is the address of the emergency? Okay, tell me exactly what happened.
I don't know. I just woke up right now, and I went and looked at him. So rolling over, and his lips are all purple.
Are you with him now?
Yes.
How old is he?
50.
Is he awake?
No.
Is he breathing?
No, and he's cold.
Okay,
God, I got the fucking
That's
chills.
That's pretty much like, guys, don't rush. Don't have to rush over there.
Why are these made public? These are weirdly private moments.
Well, aren't they?
Why does your body go cold when it's still kind of warm in the area? For real. I'm not even joking. For real.
Like, room temperature isn't 98.6.
Right.
You know, whatever your skin temperature even.
Yeah.
So once that core temp drops.
So like 70 actually feels cold?
Oh,
you know what
yeah.
I'm trying to say?
I feel like, yeah.
When you touch, maybe because you're used
when
to.
When you're used to, you know.
Touching someone's body and it feels warm, 70 must feel really cold.
Yeah.
Oh, and he's cold. Well, he doesn't have a product to solve that one.
No.
No, that's a bad one.
Oh, wow.
He's cold.
That's okay. We can still help him, okay?
Oh,
did you
boy.
See what happened?
No.
All right, listen, ma'am. Listen, we're going to help him until they get there. You hear me?
Yes.
All right, I want you to get him on the floor.
Frank, I need to get him on the floor.
Okay, let's do it very quickly. I want you to lay flat on his back on the floor. Do not put any pillows behind his head.
Don't put any pillows behind his head.
Let me know when this is done.
We can't get him up, ma'am. He's gone.
Okay, well, ma'am, we can still help him, okay? How come you can't get him on the floor?
I don't know, doctor.
Hello.
Sir?
How great would this be if it ended with like some horrific product that he was pitching, and the operator tells her to pick up the product and slam it on his head because she's a disgruntled customer.
Oh, God, it's terrible.
I can't think of one of the things he used to pitch, though.
Mighty Putty.
Not the Mighty Putty, like one of those fucking...
One of those forearm lifters. Like, wait, it's just like a... You just use leverage from your forearms to lift stuff.
A
like refrigerators.
Oxy.
All right, now take the Hercules hook.
Hello.
Sir?
Yes.
Okay, we can start CPR by getting him on the floor.
It's too late.
How come?
He's gone.
Sir, we can still try and do CPR.
Cold.
Sir, that doesn't matter. Okay, is he stiff where you can't move him?
I cannot move him. He's all rigid.
Rigid?
Yes.
All right, well, they're on the way.
Okay.
All right, sir, just put away any family pets, okay?
Yes.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. You're worried about a fucking nip-nip dog.
Well, you know what's weird, though? It's like, nah, we're not even going to try.
Yeah, it's like, he's dead.
Like, that was kind of like, well, she's going like, look, you know, what are you, a fucking doctor or something like that? Put him on the floor and start pumping.
But I think you know dead when you see it.
Yeah, you probably do, but you know.
The person's like, no. This.
Even at that point, though, you know, give it the old college try.
If his color is way different and he's cold and he might be a bit on the stiff side, you know, come on.
De Niro got a more comforting call in fucking Goodfellas about Pesci. Billy Mays is gone. Couldn't be helped.
Couldn't be helped.
He's gone and that's that.
And there was nothing we could do about it.
Nothing could do.
Oh, damn. His... Ow.
Billy Mays had to answer for all those shitty products.
Damn, man.
And it just had a...
His air conditioning up. His fucking...
Eating a Jolly Rancher.
Who's that guy already on the scene? If they're just waking up out of bed, who's that man?
Maybe that's a neighbor or something.
Well, he had a lot of money. So it wouldn't surprise me if they had, like, some kind of assistant that was there anyway.
Assistant that didn't fucking want to, you know, take the effort to put him on the floor.
He had a huge house. He drove a Bentley. I mean, I'm sure the guy had... I'm sure he had some assistants in the house.
Okay. His fucking baseball card is going to be worth a lot of money now, man. Jesus.
No, you keep... It's Billy Mays.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know what, though?
Billy.
I bet you the baseball card went up a little bit because there are enough people out there that would probably go, oh, fuck.
You about Willie Mays? No.
I got to go buy one of his baseball cards now.
Billy.
Let's say hi to Matt in Philly. Matt.
Yeah.
Hey.
The way that 911 lady was talking, it sounded like so douchey. Like, she really didn't give a fuck that Billy Mays died.
Well, you mean the one who called or the lady who was trying to help?
Yeah, well, the lady on the phone, she doesn't give a shit because she doesn't know the guy.
But she seemed like
she's just
she
doing
was
her dumb
just
job.
Doing her job.
Yeah, she don't care.
Pretty properly.
She was trying to give the guy some kind of, you know.
We all would like to think that the world cares about us. No one gives a shit. Maybe a couple people really close to you care, and the rest of us don't give a
shit.
They
care about me.
Right. And that's how it works in the end, unfortunately. Sniper from Whackbag, and he puts little TM in parentheses. Mighty Putty couldn't fix his heart, so it went kaboom!
Oh, kaboom. Remember kaboom? It did kaboom. Flies away. Mighty Putty. Awesome auger.
Blue Healer from Kentucky writes, I'd like to think my wife would be beating on my chest even if I was cold.
Yeah, you'd like to think, you know.
You know, give it the old college try.
Right.
If you're dead, what is it going to hurt?
Little elbow grease. Sure. Exactly. What's going to happen? What's the worst that could happen? He gets a pulse?
All right, you turn me around. I think they should have,
they should have done something. It's the plate that grates.
Imagine Billy Mays is hovering above going, you motherfuckers, you're not even trying
could
to get my spirit
try?
Back down into my
I'm
body.
I'm hanging out here. The,
I'm
lights,
hanging.
The in, light's right there.
I'm in limbo, you fuckers. Will you start pounding on my chest?
We're looking at the greater plate.
What the fuck is that?
It's a plate with like nubs in it so you can grate in the plate.
What a worthless product.
What are you talking about?
Of course it is.
Where do you store all this shit? Obviously.
It's just that you put it up in a. You order it, you might use it once, and then you just throw it up in a cabinet and never use it again.
Obviously, these products aren't for people that live in New York City.
You know how hard
I can't even store four stupid fucking cereal bowls and a couple of coffee cups in my kitchen.
Oh, it can't hurt a balloon or a kid's hand.
Really?
So why the hell do I want it?
Really?
I want to just rub it on top of a kid's head like a yarmulke. The soft spot. Oh, I like that fake blood.
showing bad footage of someone hurting themselves, grading, a grading injury.
Yeah. Who's ever had a grading injury?
No one.
Very difficult. Chocolate, cinnamon, coconut, nutmeg. You could do anything with this grater plater.
When's the last time you had to fucking shred coconut or nutmeg? I need something to shred nutmeg, and I have nothing to do it. The party is ruined.
You know,
idiocy.
It's brilliant, though, because people see this and go, oh, I need that. And then, like Ant said, you use it once, and then you're done with it.
Throw it away.
You use it when it comes out of the box. You're like, all right, let's grate something. We got the grater plate. We got to grate something. And you grate some dumb thing, and then you throw it in the cupboards forever.
I wonder if the
and then someone finds it when you're dead.
I wonder if the Just for Men hair dye is poisonous. Maybe that's it. 50 years old, not one fucking gray hair in that beard.
We got that nice
stop
dark beard
it
going, huh?
And the hair, same thing.
Let's say hi to Mike in Syracuse. Mike.
Yeah, did it ever occur to anyone that she was just excited she was going to be one rich cunt and she just won all his money so she didn't want to wake him up?
Oh, wow.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. Punch out.
Wow.
Wow, that's a bit harsh.
That's ridiculous, too.
It was her fifth 911 call. You hear, like, the other ones, you hear him go like, I think he's dead.
Yeah.
Ma'am, just shake him. No.
Is the Tool Bandit magnet? And you put it on your arm, and then all your tools stick to it.
Oh, boy.
Why would you ever need that?
This
how much work are you doing
stupid.
Around the house?
Horrendous.
That's the cool thing about that show, Pitchmen, because they would show the inventors of these products, and they'd tell their story, like how they came up with it and stuff.
I hear Pitchman is a great show.
I remember this one.
I gotta watch that.
The guy's
thing.
Like, he was watching his father, hammer nails, and he was putting the nails in his mouth to hold them. And then the inventor just goes, "And I saw my dad do that, and I just said there has to be a better way."
Yeah, I'll put magnets in his mouth.
Yeah,
no
you guys,
dummy.
We got horrific CPR phone calls coming in. This rules. Pat in Nebraska, what's up?
Hey, good morning, guys.
Hey, Pat.
Hey, my brother and I got a call from my nephew, and he had said my sister had committed suicide. So we went over to her house, and she had suffocated herself in a plastic bag.
Oof.
And I pulled the bag loose, and I tell you what, after I saw that, there's no way you could perform CPR.
Why?
She was completely purple, and the bag was full of fluid.
What was the fluid? She threw up, or was it like carbon dioxide?
I suppose she leaked in there, probably threw up or something. Oh. I don't know. But I just grabbed my brother and drug him out of the room. I said, there's no way. We're not even going to. She's gone.
Who could do that? Like, that's a really rough way to go. Like, people who can commit suicide by putting a bag over their own head, like.
Well, that's some anger.
But to be able
you're
to
very angry
not pull the
point.
Bag off your head.
I know.
Well, I've got an uncle that's a pretty serious alcoholic, and he said that a good alcoholic knows about when they're going to pass out. And she probably drank to that point, put the bag on, and passed out inside the bag.
Oh, and that's why she puked.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. That sucks, bro. Sorry about that.
You bet.
Eek.
All right. Should have tried some OxyClean to clear out those arteries. That's Trey.
Yeah, that's what everybody
that's
was.
That's the big one, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's say hi to Alan in Jersey.
Yeah, I was listening to the grater pit thing there, and I didn't understand why would you need a grater when everything is grated already in the grocery store for you.
It's not as fresh that way, sir.
Yes, we all like our own nutmeg grate. We all like to grate our own nutmeg, sir. What century are you in?
Yeah, come on, it's fun.
What was the product we were looking at where they show the equivalent of the product we all use, and then it's like, oh, how do you work this?
It's pretty much like everything.
But what was the one? We did it a couple weeks ago, and it was the most simple thing that none of us have ever had a problem with, and they show the person on the commercial fumbling with it.
Yeah.
I don't know how to work
this
thing.
There's a blanket for the Snuggie. Which
it must have been the Snuggie.
Woman used the blanket.
Oh, that's what it was. She couldn't figure out how to use the blanket.
How many people could use a blanket?
Right. Her head's out one side, my feet come out the other side.
I need a Snuggie.
That's what it was. She couldn't figure out how a blanket worked.
Everything is real. And the toilet paper thing, too, where people are showing like they're going, ooh, ow, like they're hurting their arm trying to wipe their ass.
Right. All right. We got a guy that works in a funeral home.
Great.
You want to go ghoulish or what?
Ugh.
I want someone to saw into a dead body today on our show.
What?
Why not?
It's crazy.
I want to hear one of those saws, like the autopsy saw. No?
No.
John in Maine. John.
B.
Yo.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, what's happening?
Hey.
Hey, I used to work for a funeral home, and we got a call for an unattended death. And I walked into the house. I couldn't find the body. And then turn around. the guy's sitting in his armchair, and he's like halfway leaned over trying to release the leg rest, and he had a pack of cigarettes and half a bag of aspirin on the kind of the table next to him. I don't know if he was trying to go for his aspirin, but he died of a heart attack, come to find out. He had been there for a while, too, and he was fucking smelled pretty rotten, to tell you that much.
He was, like, pulling that little stick shifter thing on his his lazy boy?
Yeah, he was trying to go down a gear.
Wait a minute. Wait, so it's called an unattended death?
Yeah, whenever somebody dies and there's nobody around to witness the death, the state police call it an unattended death, and they have to be at the scene of the death to assess, like, make sure there's no foul play or anything like that.
Wow. And then you have to go in the house and find the body?
Yeah.
That's
it was fucking weird because I couldn't find him.
Right.
And I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, there's nobody here. And I turn around, and all of a sudden he's just in his chair fucking halfway leaned over, and his arm is all fucking purple.
Maybe he's trying to blow himself. He used a recliner to, you know, to do what the body can't do anymore. Really can't move like that anymore.
No.
Thank you, John.
Yep.
Yeah, here's a good point. Dave from Eatontown, cold, blue, and dead. Would you want to put your lips on that? Hell fucking no.
Oh, that's true. That is a little gruesome.
Let's say hi to Mike M. Mike M.
Hey, guys. What's up?
Hey.
Hey, man.
Hey, I'm a medic in the Northeast, and on the inverse, we went to a call once for it was supposed to be cardiac arrest, but we got there, and the 911 operator was telling the husband to do CPR on his awake wife on the floor. So she was on the floor screaming while he was forcing her CPR.
She was awake.
She was awake and saying ouch every time he was pressing down on her chest.
Ow! Ow!
Jesus. Yeah. Unbelievable. All right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
One more. Trucker Dan. Dan.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Hey, man.
What are you hauling today, by the way?
Actually, I'm not really sure. It's going to the big Home Depot. It's Weed Eaters. Yeah, sorry. I'm driving across the country.
We need
this
a whole truck of Weed Eaters?
Hey, I was going to tell you, I've probably saved seven or eight people with a first aid, like lifeguard, Heimlich, and CPR. I don't get excited at all. It's really strange. I'm completely in control and unexcited when it happens. It's just very strange. But people around me
fantastic.
Are panicky. They don't do anything. They just sit there and wave their hands like, somebody help, and they don't know what to do.
Because they never took a CPR class like yourself, dude.
Damn. I know, but it's important to do these things it's important to learn these things because, you know, I mean, I've probably saved maybe six of the eight people, you know, maybe that I've performed it on, Heimlich especially. I got a good story, though, with this my best friend's girlfriend.
No, he's
nice breast. I mean, I thought I'd make it a little more funny than usual. Nicest breast you've ever seen in your life. We were all sitting around, two girls. About six guys. She's got a jawbreaker. You know, one of those things you suck on? Huge. She's sitting there sucking on it. Somebody said something funny. And she, like, laughed and sucked in on it.
Uh-oh, yeah, it's
never good. And her eyes, like, got huge. And I knew exactly what happened. I was ready to go. She got up, waving her hands, ran to the bathroom. Everybody sat there. They looked over at her. She was, like, panicking, running to the bathroom. And everybody just sat there drinking their beers. I walked right in behind her, gave her a Heimlich. It didn't work the first time. That's how huge this jawbreaker was. I said, okay, get ready again. I'm going to push real hard on the three. It did it. It popped out. Her boyfriend was standing behind me at this point. She went running. She came running into my arms, turned around and just threw her arms around me. And just like her boyfriend didn't exist. And then the rest of the night, she sat by me. Like I was her savior. I mean, she would have died. There's no doubt about it. That thing was huge.
And what was it again?
It was a jawbreaker. One of those things
Jesus.
You suck on. Like,
yeah. And do they really fly across the room?
Huh?
Does it really fly across the room? You get some velocity behind that shit?
It might have bounced across the room. It was a small bathroom, you know. So
yeah, sure.
It just shot up against the toilet or something. The thing was huge, though, man. She would have died.
Yeah.
Took me twice to get it out. The second time, I was like, uh-oh, it's coming out this time. And I put. She said her breasts were sore for like 3 weeks.
Yeah. Nice.
Deep massages.
But she tried to make a move on me after that. It was like this kind of strange thing.
But you're gay, so
Florence
you.
Florence Nightingale.
But
syndrome.
You're gay, so you said no. I can't do this, right?
Well, I've always had a rule that to never mess with your best friend's women. I mean, I've always been that way. I've always been that way. I've never messed with my best friend's women ever when I could have on a couple occasions.
What is Florence Nightingale syndrome? Is that a real thing?
Yeah, it's when somebody saves your life, like a doctor or something like that, and you get this connection with them. Sometimes women fall in love with the men. Sometimes men fall in love with the men because they saved them. Things like that. Mm.
Yeah, exactly. She, I mean, Florence her boyfriend was trying to jump in there after I got the jawbreaker out.
I'm here now, honey.
Around me like he didn't exist. I mean, it was kind of like.
Dan, I liked your call, but at this point, everyone on Instant Feedback is saying, shut the fuck up already.
Yeah, we've all had more than our share of you.
We've had.
All right. Fucking,
I thought it was pretty cool. She had nice breasts, and her breasts were.
Dan.
All right, we get it.
Modesty.
No, Dan, we like the call. We just got to edit you a little bit. I know you're lonely out there on the road.
Laura, yeah. I mean, it's just the story I can't just tell in two sentences. I'm sorry.
No, it still was a good story.
That's okay.
Thank you, Dan.
Yes.
You got it.
I appreciate it.
That's an excellent 13 episode sitcom you just spit out. I save lives and I squeeze titties.
Let's go to Tony. Tony is in his truck as well. Tony.
Yeah.
Hey, good morning, guys.
Hi,
morning.
Tone.
I just wanted to let you know, figured you'd be interested to know that I'm carrying a load of cadavers.
Right now?
Yeah.
Where the fuck are the cadavers going?
And what do you need a load of them for?
Really?
A load of cadavers going to the U.S. military. I can't tell you where it's going, but it's going for ballistics testing.
Ah.
Please just slam on the brakes so they all bump their little dead heads.
All you hear is xylophone noises way, coming from the back of the truck.
Oh, God.
put it this way, boys. When you donate your body to science, it could end up going to the U.S. military.
Dude, I already know that. I read a book called Stiff. If you like ghoulish books, read Stiff. It tells you everything they do with dead bodies, and you'll be amazed.
Are they going to shoot these for ballistic testing?
Yeah, they use all different types of weapons. They use airburst. Yeah. New projectile, like rifles, stuff like that.
Wow. When you sign away your loved one to science when they die, you're not like saying, well, I want him to be used in this way. It's just a general thing, and then they decide.
Sometimes their organs aren't good. Sometimes they put them on a bomb site.
Some of our relatives are being shot at after they die because they donated their bodies to science. That's absolutely true. They put them in cars.
Oh, yeah, crash test dummies.
Crash test dummies. Well, not live, but almost cadavers.
Human. Used to be live.
Sure. Yeah, that definitely happens.
Fuck that. Dude, I'm so about cremation now.
Really?
Oh, just fucking sprinkle me on a helicopter like Omar. I want to be fucking, I don't want my body rotting somewhere.
Jesus, this is some great calls.
I like the old-fashioned crypt.
Crotch Critter saying that you don't grab tits to do the Heimlich.
So. No, you kind of go under the tits, but I'm sure the tits come up when you push up like that.
You know, call me stupid, and I know you will just say stupid now, but I didn't realize so many people found their family members dead.
Yeah. Wow.
I just thought, like, I don't know. That just didn't happen.
That's how it happens.
Yeah. Ray the Trucker, Ray.
That vacuum.
Hey, Arne, love you, love the show. Later longer. Yeah, I found my brother dead on Christmas Eve morning, passed out outside for hours.
What did he die of? Was he drunk?
Frozen?
Yeah, there was alcohol, some prescription drugs, some heart problems.
Jeez.
But, I called 911 and they wanted to know if I wanted to perform CPR. I agree with the previous caller. Cold, dead, and blue is not what I want to put my lips on.
Yeah, I guess that's protocol with the 911 operators, but I think you, as a human being, go, no, it's obvious this fucking guy's dead. But I guess they got to ask on the phone to cover their own ass.
It was interesting watching the paramedics arrive and run up there as if they were going to save the day.
And then the two of them kind of looked at each other when they saw him with an oh fuck it look on their face.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
That ain't good.
All right, brother.
All right, boys. Punching out.
All right, man. Sorry to hear about your brother. Let's go to Teresa in New York. Teresa.
Hello.
Welcome aboard, Terry.
Good morning, guys. I'm a pathologist in New York City, and cool. I've done, like, tons of autopsies. But I just wanted to let you guys know that in the New York City Medical Examiner's Office, they actually use hedge clippers to cut open the bodies.
Hedge clippers?
Hedge clippers.
Oh, my God.
Because you can get around the ribs easier.
Wow.
They use the saws to take out the brains, but they only use the hedge clippers to open the body.
They do garden work with a scalpel. Creeps.
Hedge clippers.
Anyway, that's all I just wanted to tell you, because I thought you'd find that interesting.
Yes.
God. Now everyone's calling about finding their fucking relatives dead. I don't know how many more we could take. It's Mike morbid. In Massachusetts. Mike.
This is Mike in Boston.
Yes.
Hi, Mike.
Good enough. Anyways, Mike. I've got my father dead taking a shit with a cigarette in his mouth, burnt down to the ash, died of lung cancer.
Oh, really?
Right, wow.
Right to the end. He had his last cigarette, though. That's pretty cool.
Yep. Friggin' pants down, taking a dump with a cigarette in his mouth.
He died loving...
doing what he loved, smoking and shitting.
Right.
Honestly, I'm an ex-smoker, but if I knew I was going to die in 5 minutes, I'd light up and take a shit.
Did he leave a nice log? That would have been pleasurable.
Yeah.
A cigarette, a nice log, tapered dump.
The last thing you hear is plop, dead.
We have another 911 call. We get these all the time. Another guy not happy with his fast food order.
Oh, God.
Well, it may sound silly, but it landed a local man in jail, and it could have actually put lives at risk. That man and two of his friends were unhappy with their burger order at McDonald's and felt like police should handle the situation for them. They wouldn't stop calling 911, tying up the life-saving emergency line for nearly 20 minutes.
It's Andrew Michelson's job to handle life and death calls, not calls over two patties and special sauce.
I was at a McDonald's, I paid $10, and these guys gave me one burger and a fry and told me to pull around.
Okay, sir, this is not a 911 emergency.
I told him that he needed to talk to the manager and take it up with them because it wasn't something the police was going to get involved with.
But the upset man and two of his friends kept calling 911 over and over.
Sir, you just tell me I can't get a cop right here at 86th and Sunnyside Road. I'm going to sue your office right now.
You're going to sue our office because you're calling in on 911 because they didn't give you the correct food?
Okay, yeah, you f***ing send an officer right here right now because I got f***ing cheated.
You fucking ignorant cocksucker.
What is it, though?
That there you go. That makes perfect sense. Thank you, Danny.
What is it? Did he get the change?
Dummy.
What was he complaining about?
I could say like a
cheese.
Few things.
I heard cheese.
It sounds
like... I
got like,
cheated, I think he said.
Yeah, it sounds... It's kind of weird, but it almost sounds like they didn't give him all of his food. Like, he paid more money than what he got. And they wouldn't... Like, I guess they were arguing, and like, they wouldn't... And help him out. I don't know.
What is the difference, and just to play devil's advocate, like if that's a legitimate call, like if they don't give you the right amount of money back and they're refusing, what's the difference between that and just walking by someone who has money on their table and just taking it off? It's like they're fucking stealing from you, and the option is I'm going to go in there and knock somebody's fucking teeth out. I know 911 is not the answer, but it's like how do you...
You know what you do? You fucking calmly talk to the manager and explain the situation, and I bet 99% of the time it all works out in the end. Because they just, you know, these dope fucking managers there, unless they got a stick up their ass, probably are just like, you know, but I'm sure one of these fucking guys, I could tell by his picture, he just looks like a fucking cocksucker. Hey, where's my fucking shit? Motherfucker, all right, shut up. Good. Ugh.
He started cursing and... You know, we get that a lot, where people will, you know, try to abuse us and take it out on us.
The three men made such a scene outside the drive-up window that other McDonald's customers started calling 911, fearing for the safety of restaurant employees. Meanwhile, the upset men used a new tactic to get attention from dispatchers.
Oh, my God, the lady at McDonald's has a gun pointed to my head. I'm going to send a cop.
Does she have a gun pointed to your head?
Yep, right now. You're going to send a cop?
Yes, I'm going to send you a cop.
What is your name?
My name is Charlie Martin.
Police say there was no gun, They arrested 23-year-old Jeremy Martin for improper use of 911. His two friends fled the scene. Well, dispatchers say the abusive, selfish 911 calls could have easily put other lives at risk, all over a hamburger.
I got robbed for my money.
Sir, you did not get robbed. I'm going to disconnect with you now.
Oh, good. This one guy won't get anything, though.
And if there's three thugs outside your thing making like an $8 fucking beef, and if your company fucked up, why wouldn't you just give them their change? Unless they were wrong.
Yeah, at that point, fuck them. Fuck them. God, that's annoying.
Ugh.
That happens too much. Yep. The 911 thing.
Ignat, motherfucker.
Let's go to Larry. Larry.
Yo.
Hi, hey. Larry.
Hey, the guy said that they wanted them to pull around. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. They have timers on their fucking drive-thru. So if they're there too long, the company gets a bad note that the guy's sitting there too long. So they bring the rest of his food order out while he pulls around front.
Yeah, I've had to do that before. They tell you pull up and you wait in a little area and then someone comes out with your shit.
Yeah, and this dumb motherfucker doesn't get it. It's a pretty easy system.
No, he doesn't.
All right, guys. Punch
dumb
down.
Motherfucker.
All right, sir. Well, the hedge clippers got a few people pissed off. Mike in Chicago, what do you got on the hedge clippers, Mike?
Hey, guys. Hey. That girl's completely full of shit. They have very specialized tools. They don't just grab garden implements to do an autopsy. She didn't sound much like a pathologist either. I've done a bunch of autopsies. She sounded like a freaking idiot. They use something called a sternal saw that goes from the vertex all the way down to the xiphoid process to open the rib cage. Beyond that, there's a Y incision that goes right below the xiphoid process that they can access all the other internals, pancreas, liver, intestines, et cetera.
All right, is there a tool you guys use that looks kind of like hedge clippers?
I can't think of anything like that. The sternal saw looks just like a mini reciprocating saw.
Sure. Well, hold on. Danny has one up on this thing here. Dan, I've seen that too. That's the one that opens up. It looks like a giant plier, but it opens up and probably snaps shut with a blade.
Yeah, this is called rib cutters.
Yeah, rib cutters. Yeah, that's not hedge clippers though. There's it's just a bone snip.
It looks more like
a pair of tin snips or something like that.
Yeah,
absolutely.
How strong are they? Do you open them up and they snap shut, or do you have to push them shut?
No, you've got to apply force to cut through the bone.
Oh, ugh.
Oh, God.
Good time. Just like cutting a set of baby back ribs.
Does it make a nice sound when it snaps?
Oh, of course it does.
That was always a good feeling when you had to do something with hedge clippers and you finally got it.
Oh.
You know, it's pretty much the same. Like a small branch or something like that.
Pruning shears.
Just the right force and right through.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Love you guys. Happy birthday, Jimmy.
Thank you, buddy.
We got some info on taking a shit from David in upstate New York. What part of upstate New York, David?
$1,000 Oak.
God damn, I love that area.
Hey, I love it.
Thousand Islands? Oh!
Where is it?
I jet skied my ass off in between maybe a couple dozen of the Thousand Islands.
Is that where the dressing comes from?
Thousand Islands? You've never seen Thousand Islands? You should look up pictures. Like, there's literally 1,000 islands, and a lot of them have just one little house on them. Right? Am I lying? Yep.
Not much to do.
And you can't. You can't really visit your neighbors because it's a pain in the ass. You can't shop because it's a pain in the ass. Basically, the island is big enough for like a house and a tiny little backyard, and that's it.
Oh, my God. That's like...
Yeah, there you go.
Dude, that's sick.
How cool is that, though?
How do you not flood and die?
How cool is that?
For a lot of...
We're looking at one.
I'm surprised Anthony hadn't built his compound up here yet.
You have to leave eventually for something.
Well, they all have boats, and there's like a nearby town where you do a little shopping. I mean, it's
so your boat's like your car, I guess.
Yeah, pretty much. But we're looking at one. It's the whole island is pretty much the house. It has one huge tree.
It's a tiny house.
It's two stories though.
We do. There's a fucking fire
and a half. It's like it's a one story and then the attic.
Dude, I was jet skiing.
They're not tiny.
And you want to talk about seeing some cool shit? When you see these houses just on these islands, it's amazing.
Dude, that's scary. You know how easy that'd be to rob? You quietly sneak up on something. You break in, and that's awful.
They're mostly summer houses. Obviously, I mean, you know.
It's the same house.
How cool would that be, though? You'd spend a weekend on a tiny little island in a house?
No.
Why not?
I don't want to.
Where does your duty go?
Be on a cruise ship.
Look, and some of them look like, you know, like
that's a big house.
Glorified lighthouses. Yeah. And some are bigger than others.
That's much nicer.
Where does your duty go? Does it go into the water?
Right into the water, Jimmy.
No, oh, yeah. You're not allowed to pump duty in the water.
Oh, yeah. I was jet skiing right over duty. Huh?
You have sewage systems built in.
Oh, okay.
Are you near Canada, David?
Yeah, Canada is right across the St. Lawrence River.
Yeah. What's the town over there?
I live in Clayton, which still holds the copyrights for the Thousand Island Dressing.
Yeah, I think I fucking did a little boating in your area. Brother Weeze, every once in a while, takes his boat all the way across to that area.
Where is Thousand Islands, though? It's like how near Rochester?
It's like...
the Thousand Islands runs in...
There you go. Danny's showing you. It's like the northeast corner of Lake... I always get them mixed up. Lake Erie? Or no, Lake Ontario.
Go out of Lake Ontario, right. Northeast out of Lake Ontario, yep. And you go up the St. Lawrence River.
There you go.
You'll start hitting the Thousand Islands. The Thousand Islands region.
I think I went in a couple miles, and I loved it, man.
There's a lot of islands.
It was fucking cool.
Holy shit.
And some of them are national parks, so then you pull your jet ski up, and now you're just wandering around a park. There's no one else on the fucking island. You feel like Gilligan all of a sudden.
Stupid and gay.
Yeah. What do you got, David?
Hey, a couple things up here. I'll be real quick, and then I'll punch out. When you take a shit, if you got a weak heart, you got any. I'm a medic. But when you take a shit, you're depressing the vagal nerve, which rests back there in that area, and that just bottoms out your blood pressure. That's how Elvis Presley died. He was sitting on the crapper, and he took a shit, and probably all those fried, Snickers bars that he ate. You know, it was probably a hard turd.
Snickers bars.
But whatever it was, you know.
So basically you're saying if you take a shit and you have a bad heart, that could be a bad combination.
It is. I mean, in fact, in cardiac units, they'll tell cardiac patients if they have to go to the bathroom, a nurse has to pretty much, well, either A, be there to escort them, or they have to have a pull rope in case they fall off the toilet so that somebody can be there to assist them very quickly.
Right.
So the next thing I got to ask you real quick is F.H. Rowley was named after your niece and your father.
Yeah.
What was your father's name?
Fred.
Great. So that's one more piece of trivia I know.
My name's Fred.
Yeah, I was supposed to be Frederick Wilford Hughes III.
Brimley. Well,
there's a little trivia for you. And my mom said, hell fucking no. We're not naming our son Frederick Wilford Hughes III.
Why not? F.W. Hughes sounds rich.
Hell fucking no.
F.W. Hughes III? Sounds like you have money.
Harumph, harumph.
My mom did the right thing. I don't want to go through life as a Fred. No offense to the Freds out there. One of my best friends' name is Fred. I hate the fucking name.
You wouldn't be a Fred. You'd be an F.W. And then the head of a board somewhere.
Yes.
F.W. Really? Hughes III entering the room.
In charge of cement bags for lunch.
Sounds very fancy.
Yeah. Does it?
Jimmy, did you enjoy whacking off in your trailer?
I did. Oh, yeah, I did, actually.
Oh, you whacked off in the trailer?
I jerked off for like 10 minutes, and a bunch of fucking kids came by, and they pounded on my fucking door. And I was like,
when you came?
Yeah, hi.
You jerked off before you went on the movie set?
Yeah, but I didn't
come.
Wouldn't
that make you tired?
Didn't matter. I was okay. I was going to be sitting for my scene.
I get tired after that
shit.
One
last question, and I'm punching out. Anthony, what were you drinking the other night when you were on, whatever it is you do?
Every time I have a beer, it's a Bud Light. Unless, you know, it's a Guinness, but that's the weekends.
Well, okay, wasn't a Guinness. That's what I noticed. So, yeah, Bud Light?
Bud Light. It's like lemonade.
Okay, thank you, guys. Punching out here.
What the fuck was that about? Too many personal questions.
Yeah, another fucking stalker.
What is he, profile?
Jesus.
You got a stalker?
I don't know what the fuck's going on. Guy decides to just come over my house.
What?
You had a guy come over your house?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, listener. Just fucking comes by.
You're kidding, right?
Found out where I lived.
Knocked on the door?
Just knocked on the door. I answered the door. I'm like,
did he invite him in?
How you doing? He goes, oh, I just figured, saw you're home. And
wow.
I was like, yeah, all right. You want a beer?
You bring him in?
In the back. I figured, I didn't know at that
way to
point,
discourage him.
I didn't know at that point what to do.
Your door's going to be ringing all day.
No, because I made a point after that. I mean, yeah, isn't that great? Yeah, that's wonderful.
What?
There you go. That's nice.
Oh.
That's just beautiful. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for that. I think
can
that
you be blocked from that?
I think that could be dealt with, yeah, to tell you the truth. Yeah, I'll get right on that. Jesus Christ. Anyway, yeah. So, but I'm thinking, okay, there's two ways I could go here. I could, you know, tell him, hey, look, shove, take off, I'm busy, or I'm doing, or whatever. And
well, you could say, sure, I'll be happy to sign that album, Mr. Chapman.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I figured it would be a better way to find out who this is and what they're up to, you know, and to maybe discourage other things by showing that I'm really not to be fucked with. Because I did come to the door fully loaded. And I say it all the time. I go, people fucking, they laugh. They call me a maniac because I'm fucking got a .40 caliber on my hip when I'm at my house. But then 9:30 at night, someone's knocking on the door. I open the fucking door up. There's some guy. I don't know him from a hole in the fucking wall. So what the fuck? And I didn't even have an overshirt because I'm at home, so I don't have to fucking conceal at home. So I'm just standing at the fucking door. I got a pistol on my hip, and I'm fucking like, hello, can I help you?
Why are you opening the door, man? Why aren't you talking through like a little intercom system?
Because you can't shoot people through an intercom system.
No, but you can find out who they are.
I'm teasing, of course. Oh. No, I kind of look through the little window thing. And then I open the door.
You don't have an intercom system?
Not right at the front door. I got one. Like, if somebody rings that little bell, I could talk to them from the phone. I could pick up the phone and be like, hey, so if I'm upstairs in the room, I could kind of talk to downstairs, shit like that. But, no, so he comes over, and then he sits down and have, you know, a beer. And Danny was there, which is good, you know.
Was he a psycho, Danny?
Well, to be perfectly honest, I had no idea that this guy was just some dude because it was very, like, the conversation was very flowy and natural.
See, I was getting info and seeing what he knew, and apparently he knew a lot about, like, my past and my stuff, but stuff that I've said on the show.
Maybe it's an old friend.
No, because I said, you sure I go, wasn't did your you brother? Go to John Glenn or something like that? And he goes, no, I went to Half Hollow Hills. I'm like, I didn't know anybody from Half Hollow Hills. Mm. But he knew, like, that I used to hang out at, like, the House of Beer in Elwood and shit like that.
And it was little things like that.
People that I knew, but... And then he was like, oh, yeah, you with that black bicycle. And I'm like, what the fuck? Like, what? And
he just knew you from the past.
He knows... No, dude, I don't know this fucking guy. I don't know the name. I don't know this guy.
But then the part that really started to creep me out was he said something like, he's like, yeah, I drove by some other time.
Oh, my God, yeah, yeah.
He's like, yeah, the lights were on, but yeah, I didn't come by. She's like, why are you doing that?
He fucking and I found this out.
That's creepy.
He Twittered my sister and said, like, I went by Anthony's house just a little worried. The music's blasting and the lights are on. His truck's out front, but I can't find him. I'm like, yeah, maybe I'm fucking, or maybe I'm fucking, like down in the movie theater or in the studio or somewhere, and yeah, I have the music blasting because I'll be up in a minute, or...
It was a complete...
Like,
Rupert.
Why would she worry? Oh, why would it you worry my sister, too? Like, worrying my fucking sister, saying I was just a little worried. Like, don't fucking worry my family, because my lights are always on. I have a $1,200 electric bill.
Wow.
And... It was a complete Rupert Pupkin moment.
I'm having a heart attack over here.
I'm having a heart attack. It's like, yeah, come in. And
I
was so taken aback.
He got his phone out at one point, and he was just like, oh, let me just call my house. And then he's just like, hey. He's like, oh, did I wake you? Oh, here, wait, I got someone to talk to you.
Yeah, yeah. That's the fucking worst.
Yeah, no, I'm in his backyard. And then it's like, yeah, and then he puts his daughter on the phone. I'm just like, hi, yeah. What? And all the time, I'm just kind of assessing the situation and realize I'm like, there's just something a little off here. This is it's a little weird. So I just kept talking about my extensive gun collection and how I
how'd you get rid of them?
Constantly have. I was like, well, I'm, you know, well, it's getting a little late. Yeah, it's time to go. And he was like, I'd love to check out, you know, the what you got going on downstairs. I was like, yeah, it's late. Check out what's going on downstairs. What? Out of here!
What? You had him in the... Wow, he would have never made it anywhere near my stuff.
Well, no one knows where you live.
Well, no, it doesn't matter.
Can't get past your doorman.
You should just tell him to freaking go. You're
busy.
Well,
that's one of the things. I wasn't
sure the guy's listening, obviously. The move was. How about he calls the show and find out? Let's find out what that was about.
He called another program that I was on. Mm. I had a discussion with him about the whole thing and how weird it was. And, you know, and then he was saying stuff like, well, you got to understand my side of it, too, because it was weird for me to be able to, you know, to come up like that. It's like, well, then maybe you shouldn't have done it.
I told you what you had to do.
What?
I'm not saying on the air. I told you what you have to do. Last time I was there.
Oh, get somebody to walk the perimeter?
Well, that would be good, but no. I told you what to do.
Can I have a doorman?
It's obvious now.
Gated?
Yes!
I agree with Opie.
Gate up?
Yes, you can.
Yes, that's what people do.
I can.
Why can't you?
It's a fucking town.
You're not allowed to
put
a gate up?
You can't put a front fence up. Then? No fucking way are you allowed to put a front fence up.
Come on.
Welcome to suburbia. I had to fucking go.
What about all those other towns?
A 6-foot fence in my backyard for a pool.
What about all those other towns that have? You have special circumstances.
No, doesn't matter. It's not a gated.
Every time you see a nice gate, you know someone of
can't do that.
Fame lives there. Can't do it. It's obvious.
I don't. It's. I'm fine. Believe me, I consider myself pretty well protected. To tell you the truth, I really do. Knock wood. But I just thought that was like the oddest fucking thing, to have happen. But yeah, it's the scourge of the new technology. It's just what it is. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? But I know who it is. I got, you know, names. I got pictures. I got everything else. So
well, you should call the show and let's find out what the fuck that's all about.
It's like people get like a little overzealous. Like I have to think to myself, how would I be if I knew where, say, De Niro lived, and I knew I could knock on a door and would he open it? Because I have Paul Stanley's cell phone. Dice gave me Paul Stanley's cell phone, and
you didn't call it.
I did. I blocked the number.
Did you hang up right after?
I just wanted to hear the message once. I only called it one time. And I heard his outgoing message, and that was it. I never called again. I'm not going to hassle him. It was one time and done. And if he would have answered, I would have just asked for another person, and I never would have bothered him again.
Yeah.
But I had to make the call once. So if I knew where Paul lived or De Niro or Ozzy Osbourne, I would probably.
But I wonder if Paul Stanley is okay with you calling it once. You know what I mean?
No. Why would he be? His number. Yeah. I mean, we interviewed him once. He'd probably go, oh, hi. Like, what the fuck do you want?
Yeah.
It's invasive. It's inappropriate.
A lot of people are saying they'll be stopping by your house later this weekend.
All right.
They're very excited now that you set a precedent.
Cool. Precedent.
This guy, him and his boys will be up to see you this weekend.
Okay.
This guy wants to know what you're doing later.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
I guess you did what you thought, you know, you should do at the time.
I did.
I would have been too freaked out.
To me, to go like, hey, what are you doing? Get out of here. Would seem to me to maybe... if there was going to be a problem, to bring out aggression.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'd have been, like, looking over my shoulder the whole time, like, leaving and everything like that, which I do anyway. But it just would have seemed to me to be a little more hostile if I would have done it that way than to just go, all right, let me do it this way. I'll gather up some info. If I send some guy away, I don't know who the fuck he is, where he's from, what he's doing. Now I got all the information that I need to get any kind of complete background check or anything like that on this guy. I got all the info. I got name. I got picture. I got apparently he follows everybody on Twitter also. You're there.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy. Dan. Travis. Everyone's followed, by the way, except... me.
Mm-hmm.
It's very odd.
Why?
I don't know. Isn't that weird?
Yes.
Yeah. Very weird.
You have interesting tweets.
Hmm?
You have interesting tweets? Like, why wouldn't they follow you?
I don't know. Well, I don't know why he doesn't.
He probably does under a different Twitter name.
Maybe it's a different Twitter name, perhaps. I don't know. But I was sent, like, an email last night from somebody that had some contact with this guy, and said he was, you know, a little off kilter at certain times, being a little weird with certain message board posts and things like that.
Hmm.
So now I'm just kind of like, all right, well, what are you going to do?
That's why I like having security in my building. Not that he's a dangerous guy, but it shows you that you can. But then again, you know what? Dangerous people can be anywhere. It really is. We're public figures, quote unquote.
That's what it is. You know, you're a public figure. People feel this. I don't know what it is. They really do feel like they are entitled to pop by or something.
Well,
it's like, and then to tell me that he came by on like Father's Day, and I wasn't there, but the lights were on and the music's playing, and then to Twitter my sister and tell her that, like, what, that it's completely not his place. And then to, you know, I didn't even talk to my sister about this. She never mentioned it to me, but, you know, maybe he worried her with that. I need to do it. I always have my lights and music on. What the fuck am I doing? Doing something.
More importantly, Matt has a very good point here. Matt on Long Island.
Yeah, the saddest part of this story is that Anthony's stalker has been over his house as many times as Opie has.
That's funny.
Goddamn, John from John on the phone there.
Oh, yeah, let me go to four. We'll go there next. Tim in Atlanta. Tim.
Hey, good morning. Anthony, I've got the perfect solution for you.
Yeah?
A giant black man that carries the umbrella for Michael Jackson is looking for work. You need to hire him for security.
Ah, there you go.
Yeah, he's out of work, Ant.
All right, check it out, guys.
Let's go to John, who's calling from Ant's house. John.
Yeah, we can't figure out how to turn off that Guinness tap and the damn projector. How do you turn that on?
You need some help? All right, I'll send Keith over. He'll help you.
Let's go to Tom in Stony Brook. Tom.
Hey, what's up, boys? How are you
doing? Hey, man.
All right.
Hey, Ann, I hope when I come over this weekend, I see a little sign out front that says trespassers will be shot.
Yeah. Wasn't he commenting that my NRA sticker
should
have been near the doorbell?
For all of you that have been to Anthony's house, he has this big, you know, like double doors, and there's an NRA sticker, and the guy had commented when he came in. He goes, yeah, he's like, you know, you got that NRA sticker on the left, but no one's going to see it because the doorbell's on the right. And I didn't really think about it so much at first, but then later on it was running through my head, and I was like, this fucking guy, he was peeking in through those windows, and that's how he saw the sticker.
Exactly.
Because he was looking through those side windows.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, what a fucking creep.
And then he's like bad-mouthing ex-girlfriends.
Dude, it was weird.
Your ex-girlfriends?
To the point where, it's like, what are you fucking, like, what do you know? That you can just talk like this. It was really odd. Me and Danny are just texting back and forth the whole time.
He brought up something like, you know, from my personal life, and I was like, well, that's something I don't feel like talking about.
Like, hey, Danny, what about, you know, this situation or this? And Danny goes, well, you know, I don't feel like talking about that.
There's a weird aggression in people sometimes, like, because I know it's weird. It's like, you know what it's like to be a hardcore fan of something. And then I know the difference between somebody who's a hardcore fan and loves, you know, the show or whatever, the act. And then there are people who have a very weird aggression. And again, I don't know who this guy is, but I've had that with certain people, too. It's a weird interaction where it's like if you do the slightest thing they don't like, there's an aggression that comes out of them. And it's like, yeah, you know, you're not as much a fan as you are.
Yeah.
Something else.
You know? Yeah, but, yeah. That's what it was. And that's what I was picking up because from what I was told last night and what I was shown – certain posts and things like that. It was like, okay, there's some kind of, you know, passive aggressiveness going on here and this weird kind of, you know, getting into arguments with certain people that are friends of mine and thing. Very odd. Yeah. The nosy. Yeah.
Wow. Should we take a break?
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, take a break. We got to discuss a couple of things.
All right, Opie and Anthony.
Can I welcome everyone back?
James, if you would.
Welcome to Norton and Friends.
Norton and Friends, why?
Featuring my friend Anthony Cumia and my friend Opie, who is right now taking a nice dump.
I bet. Taking a nice hurry.
It's always weird when you walk in the bathroom, and I think that's where Opie was. But I walk in, and there's only one stall door closed, so I want to start talking to him, but I'm like, Ope? It's so creepy to call your friend's name while he's shitting.
Hello? That's why you got to just peek underneath.
Yeah.
Hi!
Yeah.
Get your face down there with a nice smile.
I put my dick under, and he tooted on it with his hand. I'm like, all right, it's him.
Tootily toot.
He gave it a little squeeze.
Yeah, I passed by the studio, and I didn't see Opie there. I hope everything's okay. Yeah, Opie's taking a little bit of a dumpy wumpy.
Yeah, it seemed like a short break. I took a piss and I came back and it's time to be on the radio again.
Yes!
And Sean William Scott is coming here.
Today?
Oh, my God, yeah, about an hour and a half.
A co-star motion picture that James is in.
Yes, he's supposedly he's very funny at it. I did not have my scene with him, but... I read the whole script while I was getting my fake tattoos put on.
Yeah, and which you still have on.
It's easy to say it's fucking... I honestly got laughed out loud reading the script.
Good?
Fucking hilarious. You never read funny scripts. They're always terrible. But this is a really funny fucking script. And you can hear Tracy Morgan in every Tracy Morgan line.
Oh, it's totally written like...
Perfect.
Obviously, he should be saying the line.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah, you were there for how long are you on that too? Because I know, like, it takes a long time to film like a short little segment.
Well, they didn't know
on there for a while.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
It was about a 10-hour day, 11-hour day.
Really?
Yeah. And
that's cool.
I didn't know what time I took off yesterday because I was like, well, we didn't know. Originally, they said it was going to be an early call, then they said it was going to be noon, and then they said it was going to be early again. So I was like, let me just fucking. You know, and they wound up making it earlier. So I had to be there. I got picked up at like 11 o'clock, which was actually much later than I was thinking. And get there at noon. I'm in the makeup chair at about 2:30. And
is it done out in the street?
Oh, no, no, no. Where? One I did was inside of a tattoo parlor.
Oh, okay. But was it like a real tattoo parlor?
Oh, yeah.
In New York City?
In Brooklyn, in fucking Bensonhurst. You've never seen so many white people in your life. They don't play games out there. Oof. Spike Lee has a point. I think that's where we were. They don't fuck around. Oh, they were fucking hardcore, man.
Yeah, they were
great, but they were hardcore fucking Italians. You didn't play games with them. Yeah.
Were there a lot of people like trying to...
It was a fucking mob scene.
Looky-loos.
It was a mob scene outside of... Because my friend Rob and his brother Mark wrote the film. And Rob goes, it's a fucking zoo. Everywhere we go, it's a zoo. And they're actually being polite. The crowds are not being animals. They're not yelling and screaming. But they're all just standing outside waiting to see Bruce or
Tracy.
They
want to see a big star.
Yeah, it was great to just walk out there and be a nobody.
People are like, who's that?
Yeah. A couple of fans came over and said hello. And you know what I mean? So there were some O&A fans, but they were across the street. And
Yeah.
But it was...
They roped off those mooks. Kept them out of the picture.
I had to play scared. I'm like, I don't know how to play scared. I'm not good at that. And
would you fart? I was scared. This is how I play scared.
And I was sitting. I had to sit in the tattoo chair. And I'm not going to give away the whole scene, but let's just say that Bruce Willis. The scene is supposed to start with him holding a tattoo needle over my eye.
Wow.
Threatening me.
Awesome.
And I'm like, I don't know if I should play this scared or aggressive. So they're like, all right. So they lay me back in the chair. And Tracy Morgan, Tracy is actually lying over me. He was actually hurting me because I had worked out the day before, you know, trying to get the guns in shape.
Of course.
It really was like jogging fucking from here to the corner the day before the marathon.
You really worked out the day before?
The 2 days before. I did cardio and swimming, and then I did some elliptical.
This will make me look great on film.
Yeah, this will buff me up.
You should have just did push-ups just before your scene to pump up a little bit.
There was no room in my trailer. It was like the fucking, it wasn't even, the one I had on Zach and Mary was a fucking, was Anthony's house compared to what I had yesterday. It was literally, like, if you leaned forward, you banged your head on the other wall, and you had to share a common bathroom at the end trailer.
Ooh, with Bruce?
No, I don't think so.
No, huh?
No, Bruce actually just shit on copies of my headshot and resume.
Smeared it in nice.
But
that's fucking cool, man.
He was. We rehearsed, and he literally Tracy's laying on top of me, and Bruce has his hand on my fucking forehead, and he's just standing over me with this fucking needle over my eye, and he was fucking so nice and safety. All he wanted to make sure is that I didn't jab my eye out.
Right.
So he's like, "Hey, can you see Jimmy's feet here? He made them build something on the end of this chair." So
lift.
He looks a little short.
Yeah.
The wing's gonna fall off the back. And he made them actually put clamps and build something on the end of this chair, so I could brace my feet during the struggle, so I wouldn't actually slide down and get my fucking eye poked.
Oh, wow.
He was great, man. He was fucking surprisingly nice dude.
Fucking John McClane, dude.
Yeah, but you think of that, too. It's like, after a few minutes, you get used to it, but then he leaves and he comes back in, and you're like, where's Bruce? Oh, there he is. And you realize
Bruce Willis.
And he, like, he asked me to dab my forehead at one point because I was sweating.
Oh, so, no. His hand is getting all sweaty on
you. Yeah, my fucking greasy head, poor
Could
Bruce.
Could you wipe your fucking greasy head? Oh, God.
I don't want to interrupt this because we could do this.
Oh, no.
Do you want to take that? It's up to you.
No, it probably should. He probably shouldn't, right?
I don't know what you mean.
I'm thinking.
You already put it out there, so.
That guy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, good. Record it. It'll help me. It'll help me with certain licensings. Yeah, go ahead. Hi.
Hello, Anthony.
Hi. How are you, sir?
I'm fine. Let's just put things in perspective here.
All right. Let's do that.
Okay.
You came to my house in the middle of the night.
Okay. We had spoken a number of times on your other thing. You knew I knew where your house was because we had spoken about it. You invited me over. You said to me, if the music is on...
I said that to get rid of you!
No, you said ring the doorbell.
I did.
Sure. You said, sure, come up and ring the doorbell. You said that.
Anthony. Anthony invites somebody, they show up.
I mean, like, crazy? Attitude,
let's put another thing into perspective. I wasn't just standing at your door. I was leaving. I rang your doorbell. No one came to the door. I was getting in my truck 50 feet away from your front door when you came to the door.
That's because Danny came back and said, someone's at your door, dude. So okay. I opened the door to see who the fuck was at my door.
And the person was leaving with me. I was getting in my truck and leaving. And then you invited me. I walked up to the door to
meet
you.
No, I said, hello, can I help you?
Okay, so I walked up to the door.
Right.
And explained who I was. You invited me in and said, would you like a beer?
Exactly.
You brought me into the house, down to the basement, and poured me a beer.
Right.
Okay.
I was being cordial.
The thing is, if anything, I was the one that said I was going to leave. When we were out back and you guys were getting ready for the show, I'm like, I'm getting out of here. I wasn't told to leave. I said, you know, enough.
I said, I looked at my watch and went, yeah, I think I'm going to get doing the show. Right?
If anything, in the discussions we were having, wasn't I even saying to you, aren't you going to do the show? And you were even saying, yeah, these people are getting all over me.
Yeah. You know, you're right. Hey, maybe I should have handled it different. Maybe I should have said, you know, just maybe go away. I have no idea. What are you getting at?
I apologize if I scared you in any way.
You didn't scare me in any way.
And rang the doorbell. If you didn't say to me a couple of weeks ago when we had a discussion on air and you knew I knew where your house was and I said, to you,
yeah,
like, I like
exactly.
Home, you
that was me. That was the kicker right there was that. You knew where my house was.
And you still said to me after the fact that I knew where your house was, that, yeah, if the music is on and the lights are on in the backyard, ring the doorbell. I didn't bring that up. You did. All right?
This guy's getting a little
confrontational.
Radio bit
out of this thing. It's just that's exactly the way it was. And I'm not a problem, and it's going to be a one and done. You won't have to worry about me coming over there ever again.
You pretty much just kind of like you're a fan of the show, and you just kind of wanted to meet Ant, and you said, what the hell, I'll give it a shot.
Jerry.
All right.
I'm asking you. Like, you're just a fan.
It goes back to where I initially was a Howard Stern fan, and when I started listening to the show for the first time, I started realizing, like, wait a minute, this guy knows a lot of people that I used to know. He grew up exactly where I grew up. So, yeah, it intrigued me. I think it would intrigue anybody.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's all it is. It's not an obsession.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'll say this. If I had the, like I said, the chance to go by someone's house just to, and all, you know, I might do it. You know, it's not that crazy.
I mean, if he had not said to me, ring the doorbell, I never would have done it.
See?
I know where, Anthony, I've known where your house is for the last 3 or 4 years.
See, don't you find that a little weird to just say and blurt out every maybe 5 minutes? That you know where I live. Don't you? Do you think me, as a person that is in the public eye, likes to hear people constantly tell me they know where the fuck I live? Do you know? Do you understand? That's a little disheartening to me. It's a little fucking weird to me. Not just that people do know where I live, but that for someone to bring it up this many times is a little weird. Do you understand that, maybe?
Well, then maybe you shouldn't be inviting that person over. Can you understand? That's a little weird.
Do you understand I say certain things, and you're absolutely right. Maybe I should shut my fucking mouth that I say certain things. And if you watch Rupert Pupkin and The King of Comedy, you'll see that Jerry once told Rupert, yeah, come by or do this or do that. And he took it literally.
Anthony, that
it's,
was a movie.
It's my
that
whole fucking
thing. This is real.
My
this
whole
real.
M.O. Yeah, exactly. This is real. My whole M.O. is, you know, all right, I'll say things. I never think people are actually going to fucking at 9:30 at night or whatever it was knock on my fucking door. That's what I mean. So you know something? Yes, I've been educated very valuable education from you, sir, that I will never again bring that up. The fact that you kept telling me you knew where I lived, I was trying to appease you a bit. Because
by
you kept...
If you see the lights on and you hear the music blasting, ring the doorbell. That's appeasing? That's inviting.
Yes, that's appeasing. That's appeasing because I didn't think anyone in their right mind would actually do that. But, okay.
I mean, just right, to kind of mention that you've been around before.
Line,
and
well, this is Danny.
Bottom line, I am not a problem, and it was a one and done. You won't have to see me ever there again.
To me, you don't, honestly, you don't sound like a problem. You sound like somebody who just... a little overzealous, which is not necessarily dangerous. It's just you have to understand from the other side because you're just looking at it like, hey, I'm a fan. I came by. On the other side of it, like when you're quote-unquote in the public eye, even though the fan or the listener is well-intentioned, it can be a little scary just because all of a sudden there's someone at your door, even though your intentions are not bad.
I'm sure. Absolutely. But the thing is, when that person – I mean, Anthony easily could have said to me, you know, I'm busy right now. You know, he invited me into his home.
I was put in a bit of an awkward position right there. And to tell you the truth, I was trying to get as much, you know, background on you as I could.
Okay.
Fine. You know, we had a beer, nice conversation.
So when you...
No problem.
So when you invited me over, you didn't mean it either?
No. I wanted to get all the info on Opie that I could possibly get.
Ant was taking cell phone pictures of me. I'm like, why don't you fill these forms out, Anthony?
Yeah, really.
Release forms. I'll just leave release forms in my mailbox.
Anthony's weird with all of us.
Yeah. Why are you taking my drink cup away immediately after I'm done with it?
Yeah. Well,
see, that's a fingerprint joke. Okay.
I'm going to have to live my life more like the type of, you know, person that I just kind of didn't want to, but I feel it necessary now that I kind of have to. That's how it is. All right, are we cool? We cool?
We're cool.
Are we square?
I'm going to be the brunt of the show. Fargo. Joke. I mean, bottom line, I never would have rang the bell if you had invited me to do so.
All right.
So it's a one and done. You can go back to your peaceful life.
All right. Sounds fair
Good
enough.
Good day, sir.
You take care now.
Yes.
Thank you. That phone call ended just in time because he's walking down the hall with a big jug of water today. Why the big jug of water, Nicky?
Nicky?
All right, let's go back to the phone and say hi to Tom in Chicago. Tom.
Hey, this guy's a whack job. Bottom line is, you know, everyone should be able to detect a cordial invite by a celebrity as what it is, just being cordial, never to be meant to be taken up on.
Yeah, I mean, I say that to, you know, maybe I shouldn't say that to certain people. I have no idea. I say it to the police all the time. They are cordially invited to my house, and they pop in at all hours.
Well, they probably should be cordially invited.
They do pop in at all hours, which is fun.
Like, it's just, like, that's exactly what I couldn't get my mind wrapped around. Like, if Kevin Smith is in here and we're talking and I'm like, oh yeah, I'd love to hang out, and he'd be like, oh yeah, drop by the store one day, we'll chill.
That's exactly, thank you.
I would never actually go and be like, hey Kev, remember me? You said I could come and hang
let
out.
Let me tell you something. Danny is exactly that. Right. One time, a little man named Quentin Tarantino was on our show.
That's right.
And he was like, you guys, if you're in LA, yeah, I got the screening room and stuff. You come by, watch a movie.
Let's fucking do
that. And the thought,
I know what you're about to say, but you know what it is, Quentin Tarantino? Let's fucking do that.
Of going to the internet, finding out where Quentin Tarantino lives, dropping by his house and saying, Quentin, remember you said that we could watch a movie at your... It goes without saying that it's kind of a...
Stop comparing yourself to Quentin Tarantino.
I'm fucking more brilliant than Quentin Tarantino, my friend.
Of course we got to go watch a movie with Quentin Tarantino. What are you getting at? Don't wreck my opportunity to watch a movie with Quentin Tarantino.
Thrown out on your head.
I have to
remember when you said.
I got to point out the difference, though. Okay. The difference is, this is a daily radio show where it's like, and I'm playing just like from that other point. People kind of feel like they're hanging with us, and when you're in someone's life,
they're not.
No. What I'm saying is, you're in 5 hours a day. They kind of get to know you. It's a very interactive show.
Yeah.
Whereas Tarantino's a guy who comes in once and makes it something. But this is an interactive offer show thing.
I understand that offer thing is just a little probably.
Let's say hi to Brian.
Oh, is that Jesus Christ? Brian, look at that. There you go. Easy as pie, huh?
Brian.
Yeah.
Hey, Brian.
Ant, I was man. I was in your show the night that happened.
Yeah.
Now, everybody in the room, I love you, Jeff, man, but everybody in the room was telling you that this guy was creepy and giving everybody the deuce chills, but he was a stalker. And I remember you sat there and said, yeah, the music's on, yeah, come up, ring the doorbell. Everybody in the room was telling you this guy was a stalker because he just knew way too much about you to just be, you know, a regular fan.
Yeah, see, I'm still living my life like I'm fucking a tin knocking idiot. I'm going to have to fucking, now, what?
That's right. Let's go to Dave in Levittown. Dave.
Security. Good evening.
Good evening.
Oh, Dave.
I just want to make the note that Danny's over there, Mr. Protector of Anthony, and wasn't he always showing up like you guys did creepily in the background of old pictures and whatnot?
Oh, yeah. See, Danny was like that, only he got in the inner circle.
And
I got
and Travis and E-Rock.
Yeah, they were all creeps.
Yeah, I got invited to an event at the Hard Rock that I showed up to. I wasn't showing up at people's houses.
You weren't supposed to show up at that event.
I love the picture of Travis in the audience of the press conference.
I know, that's a
great
one. When
we were announcing we were coming to Sirius.
I was dropping off a resume
Danny at the rally.
I'm bringing that picture
fan
with me again.
Giving me his card from the bone.
Right, we just hired
at the
all
Hard Rock, which I promptly threw away.
Yeah, our old intern Ricky was at that same event.
Yeah, yeah,
good old Ricky.
They were all a bunch of. We hired a bunch of fucking creeps.
How do you think I met Dice? By fucking walking up to him at the store. Hi, I'm a big fan. And being a creep and hanging out.
Ron,
I guess it works.
Ron the trucker. Ron,
what's going on this morning, boys?
Hey, Ron.
What you need to do is just, hey, I'm going to have a bunch of helicopter buddies come over here, and we'll just fly around the compound one evening and do a little night 3D flying.
Yeah, you got to do a little night flying, a little helicopter flying.
Nah, I got security.
I got to get some cameras. A nice helicopters up there, fire up a couple of turbines, and just really buzz the shit out of the neighbor's house.
Yeah, right on. Let's go to Sean in Georgia.
Hold
on a minute.
Here is the text thing that my sister got. Here it is. It says, call your brother and make sure he's okay. I was by his house an hour and a half ago, and all the lights and music are blasting, and no A. Like, you, it seems to me you don't know me well enough to know that that's a weird thing, because it's not. To have the music going in the backyard and the lights on and me not even be back there, maybe I'm downstairs for a minute.
All right. You know, grabbing a beer. Maybe I'm hanging with friends at the bar, and then I'm come upstairs. Like, to me, that was.
All right, let's go to Sean in Georgia. Sean.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
First of all, I was with the caller until he kept saying it was a one-and-done thing and you can go back to your normal life. But, yeah. Anthony, if you're going to be advertising your place as a huge party where there's tons of young naked girls running around and everything, you probably shouldn't be throwing out sarcastic invitations.
Oh, it's and then people realize the truth of the matter is it's just me and Danny drinking a beer.
Two fucking fruits. Anthony's got the only private residence with a hole drilled in a bathroom stall.
Jesus.
Fucking him and Danny on either side pretending they don't know it's the other guy. And then neither one, after they both fill each other's mouths with goo, they never mention it when they're in the backyard drinking. Just two men talking about chicks.
Rock on Long Island Rock.
How much a carpenter charges to put in a glory hole? They're so cheap when you do them yourself.
Anthony.
Yeah.
Listen, Monday morning when Opie says it's just him and E-Rock and the other idiots and Anthony's not in, we don't want to find out that next week it's because he had a competition with some exuberant fan who decided to triangulate all of the stories you tell us about the little Italian restaurant near your house and the gym. I mean, everybody can kind of figure out what exit you hit the LIE and then backtrack and follow you. I want to go to the compound and see the naked girls, too. But the problem is, it's not matter what this guy says, it's what you do. And you really have to turn your entire brain around and be the big shot that you really are and make yourself impenetrable.
No one should fucking know based on what I talk about, where I live. Jesus.
We love.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Dave in Alberta. Dave.
Yeah, hey.
Hey, man.
Oh, am I? This is it? Yeah, no, hey, Anthony?
Yeah, what's up, man?
Could I just ask you? Hey, Jimmy.
Hey.
Opie, you really got to be careful about that stuff. Because, I mean, you turned my life around, man. There's a lot of people who really, really... I mean, I get up at 4 a.m. to listen to you guys every day, man. You changed my life. You got to be careful about those people, man. And well, I won't have anybody come
You sound like a
here.
Nice guy. Why don't you come by the house?
Sorry, I can't get across the border, unfortunately, but... yeah.
Oh, shit, why? Why can't you cross the border,
Dave? Murder rap.
Criminal record, whatever, man.
Yeah, whatever.
What'd you do? He probably murdered a radio host. He's the guy that shot fucking Bogosian's character. I said, good show, fucker. You're dead, fucker.
You're dead, fucker.
Not quite, but no, just Anthony, man. You got to be careful about that kind of thing.
I know.
A criminal's telling you that.
Yeah. You're a big man.
Yeah. This guy is probably just a fan. He's a little, again, we all get a little overzealous as fans sometimes. I've done it myself.
Exactly.
But you're lucky that it wasn't a bad situation. Like, it could have been a really bad situation.
But shit, what if the guys...
They're lucky. They're fucking lucky!
Well, everyone's lucky. I'm lucky, because, again, I have a mortgage to pay. I don't need one of you guys getting fucking popped.
What if he showed up with a gun, man? You never know. You never know, man.
What if he did? Then it would have been a great fucking battle. Would have been a great gun battle at my front door, motherfucker.
Jesus Christ.
What's wrong with you?
I'm insane.
You are insane for real.
I'm kidding. It's a character I play on the radio, dummy.
He's called Anthony Comey. An odd character.
Let's go to Rich in Jersey. Rich.
Hey, guys. Morning.
Hey, morning.
Opie, I can't remember a story you told on the air that you were in Los Angeles and you happened to stop by Barry Williams' house for dinner at some point.
Well... It's Barry insisted, kind of like Quentin Tarantino, if you're ever in L.A., stop on by and say hi. I didn't know where he lived, and I called from, where did I call from? Venice Beach. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, what the fuck? I'll give this a shot. I'm going to be out here for a while. And I called him up, and he goes, fuck, you're in L.A. I wish I had a better story where you could throw me under the bus, but he goes, fuck, you're in L.A.? Come on over. I'm like, are you sure? I was even playing that game. You really sure? He goes, yeah, come on over. And then he gave me directions to his house at that point. And then I did show up. And it was awkward. Like, maybe he was trying to just be nice because then he served me his leftovers.
Leftovers?
Yeah. They whipped together some leftovers.
And didn't he have all the Brady Bunch episodes on VHS?
Yeah, absolutely. It was all on VHS. Brady Bunch
he should have started
memorabilia
those.
All over the house.
You run out of the house like fucking leave a hole in the shape of your silhouette in the door.
It was surreal to be in his house, though, because he's like a fucking TV fucking icon.
Yeah.
But then he's I see him and his wife whispering over right around the refrigerator door trying to figure out what to serve me.
Oh no, how embarrassing.
I wish I would have, you know, spoke up and said, why don't we go to dinner or why don't we get some fucking takeout? It was some weird pea pasta dish that I hated.
Mind if I spend the night?
Because I'm a red sauce pasta guy, not that cream sauce shit.
Yeah.
But I wasn't going to say anything.
What are you going to say? It's Greg right. Brady.
Yeah, he had the cream sauce.
Oh, by the way, he had the nice red sauce over some nice fresh pasta.
Oh, he did.
Which made
he
it even,
gave you the shit.
Which made it even weirder. It was Jay. Me and Jay stopped over there.
You brought a friend?
I was hanging with Jay that day.
You told him me and my buddy are in town?
No, I said I just told Jay I'm going over there. You want to come over? I didn't even tell fucking Barry.
Oh,
you're worse than this other guy.
Because I didn't want to go there alone.
Well, he probably wanted you to come
that's
alone.
Funny.
I just didn't want to though. So I said Jay, and even Jay's like, "You sure?" I'm like, "Yeah, fuck
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
let's
fuck,
go over there."
Greg Brady.
We had martinis in the back. His wife's whipping up the leftovers.
Wow.
Barry's agent was there.
That's funny.
One of the brothers that we all know. Yeah, that's the story. There's not much else to it, really.
It doesn't have to be. That's pretty good right
there.
Was the
only,
right there.
But that was the only celebrity invite I ever took someone up on.
Wow.
We get them all the time, but for the most part, you do feel like, he didn't really mean it.
Never. That's just it.
Although Kevin Smith offered us playoff tickets, and I absolutely, you know, took him up on that because I'm a big hockey fan.
Kevin's
so.
Different, though. He's a friend, man.
You could tell that was
after the show, I'm like,
sincere, yeah.
After the show, I'm like, if you mean this, I'm there. You know that because I'm a big, you know, hockey fan. My team's way out of it. He goes, mm-hmm. No, I mean it. I'm like, all right, cool. Then I'm going. Actually, he invited a bunch of us, and it was a good day.
You've hung with
good
him
night.
For hours, though. It's not like he's not a casual. He's a guy that comes in for fucking hours. You know what I mean? He's like, yeah. He's a buddy. It's different.
Yeah, and that's it. That was the only celebrity house I ever was at. Mm. And ever. Oh, no. I hung out with Dice once, too, in his little apartment after his wife kicked him out.
Oh, you're never at the old place?
No.
The old place was nice. Big.
I felt bad for him. He had a tiny little apartment in Hollywood Hills. He's like, no, it's good. It's good. And I knew it wasn't good. He was just going through all that shit at the time. We had a good day, though. You want any more of these calls?
If they're good or interesting.
Oh, let's say hi to Jamie in Buffalo. I did pick up on this. Jamie.
Hello.
Hey, Jamie.
Hey, Anthony, at the end of that call, and he said, go back to your beautiful life. That was the only part of that call that disturbed me. It had that weird fucking creepy tone to his voice.
Well, that part, yeah. It's like, go back to your normal life or something like that. Or
no, he said beautiful life.
Did he?
Yeah. Dude just said, yeah, have a good day and hung out.
See, what, am I the asshole now?
Life.
Now am I the asshole? Because I'm fucking, no. You know.
Well, you're right.
I call out the situation as being a little creepy, and now I'm the fucking asshole.
I don't think you're an asshole.
I don't think
no.
So. That's I think you were a bit creeped out, and you want to express that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's all, Anthony. Just watch your back. You're not a tin knocker anymore, buddy. Yeah.
When he was saying it's a one and done, I didn't take that as being confrontational. I took that as being, like, I really was just going to stop by one time, and now people think I'm going to stop by more. Like, almost like, what the fuck? It was one time. Like, that's kind of how I didn't take that as being, like, fuck you, one and done.
I just don't like the constant, I know where you live. That, to me, is, I don't like hearing that, like, over and over. And I've known for 3 years. What? I don't think I've lived there 3 years. Whatever. Probably,
I don't know.
I text that I know where you live to you a lot, but that's just when I'm lonely and jerking off. Tell me what window you're in. I sent Anthony a very weird text when I'm about to come.
Any of these others you want to, you know?
Nah.
All right, we're done. All right, why don't we take a break? We're going to regroup. We got Sam. He did What's the Haps at the Gay Pride Parade.
I want to hear this. Sam probably the hit of the parade, by the way, with his twinkish little body.
Well, we'll find out. We're going to find out next. But first, we'll do a combo platter with Sam. We'll go backstage with Primetime.
And now, backstage with O&A, here is Primetime Sam Roberts.
I'm Primetime Sam Roberts, and the interns of the Opie and Anthony Show are at war. Dennis, one of our new interns, sent a text to another intern and said that senior intern Paul talks to his co-workers as if they're shit and resembles Hitler in the way he works. We got a copy of the texts and confronted Dennis to clear things up.
What do you think of Paul? Paul? She's a pretty serious guy, but, you know, he's a cool guy. guy, though.
Somebody told me that you thought that he reminded you of Hitler.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I believe he said that Paul is going to be Hitlering around tomorrow.
Which is it sounds like something I would say.
You said, I hate how Paul talks to people.
Well, like, you got me. I do.
He just talks down to people like he's better than them?
I guess.
He's
just an
intern.
I know, but he is the senior intern.
What's that? I mean,
a glorified intern.
Do you think this place would probably be more pleasant for the interns if maybe Paul wasn't around so often?
I don't know, because we have the whole, like, agreement with Sirius that we can't talk to other females and stuff, so I guess, like, you know.
What does the females have to do with it?
You know, Paul might, you know, scare him away with his pirate vibe.
With barbs like that being thrown, we had to find Paul, the ugly, glorified intern, to find out how he would react to Dennis's remarks.
Paul, you know intern Dennis?
No.
Well, this new intern, he compared you to Hitler in some text messages that he sent.
Oh, I'm aware of the text messages, yes.
He says he hates how you talk to people and you look down on fellow interns as if they're shit.
Well, if he proves he's not shit, maybe I'll look at him in a better light.
He called you a pirate and a mountain man and said that you spend your time here Hitlering around. Will you stop Hitlering?
Yeah, as soon as he shows he can fucking work on his own.
Do you think you're better than he is?
No, what the boy doesn't understand is that respect is earned, not given.
Has Dennis earned your respect?
No, I've never seen him do a goddamn thing.
But none of the interns really do anything.
Some of them do.
Does he do the least?
Couldn't even tell you.
Could you tell me that the other interns do something?
Oh yeah, definitely.
So
yeah, he definitely does the least.
Who's in the right? Is Paul an unattractive dictator? Is Dennis a lazy nobody? Yes! We'll stay with this story as it continues to develop. I'm Primetime Sam Roberts, and this has been
Backstage with O&A.
Try.
Thank you, Mr. Fallon. Thank you. You're checking out the Opie and Anthony Show.
Jerry.
Sam's in studio.
Sam.
Did the right thing. You went out there and tried to, you know, talk to the peeps.
Always.
Try to get some material for the radio show.
I like meeting new people and finding out what's going on.
And it brought you to the gay pride parade there, Sam.
Well, that's what happened to be going on this weekend, so that's where I happened to be.
Did you sample any of the goods while you were down there?
What do you mean, like foods or?
Well, sure, if you want to call it food.
Try the cock. No, I didn't try any of the any penis or anything like that.
No?
No.
How do they serve penis?
Wonderful. Tiny little shorts, apparently.
A lot of tiny little shorts.
Yes. Yeah.
See, we were talking about this about an hour ago.
Comes in a bun.
I would have. Maybe we could get some of the gay guys to call because I imagine that the tiny little.
Hello. Yes.
The tiny little shorts is not helping the cause as they're trying to get marriage legal in a lot of states. You know, the tiny little shorts might be throwing a lot of people off.
Well, it's
to
like
the cause.
A lot of gay people are upset. They think Bruno is playing too heavily on stereotypes.
Yeah, that's coming out a lot.
Right.
But the gay community still allows these crazy parades where
Pride Parade looks like something that like Bruno would fit in there and wouldn't look like out of place or wacky.
You wouldn't even notice him.
You wouldn't even know which one's Bruno.
He'd be conservative.
I hear he's in the parade somewhere.
Yeah.
You spend half the day trying to figure out which one's Bruno.
Nobody minds their stereotypes in a parade. That's celebrating their diversity. But if you're making fun of the stereotype, that's inappropriate.
Bullshit.
But the only time like the whole gay thing comes to our attention is when you see the fucking parade footage. Right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Because
so then if you're in that community, wouldn't you be like, we got to fucking calm this thing down. This is our only chance where we do get people paying attention to us.
It's the identity that they build.
Stupid!
Like, when they're fighting for political causes, they don't set up an identity.
They're not a smart group.
And then when they do set up their identity, it's like, you know, men with angel wings and underpants on.
Right. Angel wings. Oh, God, that's great.
You can't have angel wings and underpants on when you're trying to be respected.
Like they're fighting for their rights, but they are dressed like Cupid.
We just want to fit in like everyone else. Yeah. You know something?
Yeah, Cupid's trying to tell us what he thinks about gay marriage, and we're not even paying attention. You look like an idiot.
They're wearing
right
no
now.
Pants.
Right.
Yeah.
You saw some Cupids down there?
There were Cupids. There were men like with no pants.
Like just no pants.
Well, I mean, like they had little briefs on and underpants. Like some guys had these, I guess they would be considered mini skirts sort of things with no shirts, but they came up above the butt cheek.
Oh, so their butt was hanging out.
And then they were wearing underwear, but it was like almost thongish, so the bottom of the cheeks were quite
hang out. Jesus. A lot of gay guys at these parades love the bottom of their butt cheeks hanging out.
Is that the new look?
Yeah, you leave the bottom of the butt cheeks.
The high riding underpants. What do they call that style?
I'm not sure. I guess I should have asked.
You need that bit of ass meat hanging out at the bottom.
That's like cleavage for gay guys. Oh, the cheeks hanging out.
Yeah, that's cleavage.
For real?
No, I'm just guessing. It's like, it looks like two tits.
It have to be, yeah.
Yeah, you can put your dick between them. So.
Fair enough. Jeez. There's a lot of packages on display in the underpants, too. It was very nerve-wracking.
Yeah?
Yeah, what do you mean? Yeah. Nerve-wracking.
Were you sweating a little bit, Sam?
It was uncomfortable. Look yes, this that. Is a picture that Danny has brought up is a perfect example of something you might see. A lot of gay dogs, too.
What's a gay dog?
The gays, they bring their gay dogs.
But you can tell the dogs are gay too?
Wow, dude.
How can you tell a dog is gay?
It's raised to be gay.
But do they look a certain way?
They got scarves on and stuff.
Oh, fuck. The fucking dog is like...
So they know the dog a little. Yeah.
I wish dogs could talk because they're like, look, what you do is whatever. As long as you feed me, but don't fucking bring me into your world with the gay scarves and stuff.
The dogs are marching in the parade with scarves on. They don't even want
to. Oh, no.
That is hilarious.
The other dogs are looking going, oh.
Yeah. Your owner's gay, obviously.
No. Well, yeah. What do they dress you in?
Really?
Hell yeah.
Oh, my God.
That's the type of thing.
That guy's pants, they are pulled down to where they're resting on his dick. Yeah, that is right at the top of his dick.
There appears to be 8 to 12 inches between his waistline and his belly button.
Yeah.
Which doesn't
Of tattooed real estate, by the way, also. Pierced nipples. He's flexing and making a muscle as he is making out with another six-packed... gentlemen.
Great shape, though.
Well, you know, the gays, they have to
stay in good
shape
down there?
They have to.
Oh, yeah.
Unless you're a bear. You see a lot of bears down there?
No. It was more the young, shapely men.
Right. There's a couple of biker guys. Shirts, very optional.
Yeah, very few shirts. That was definitely...
I don't see many shirts.
I felt like a dork wearing a shirt.
Look, there's guys, maybe they're going to go swimming. They're wearing their underwear and
they're
nothing
on the way
else.
To the beach.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a triathlon.
I don't know.
Sometimes you're not sure if it's a gay pride parade or a triathlon coming by. You don't know.
Why don't they put out a workout tape just called Gay Abs? Because they all have abs. It's amazing.
Let's say hi to Ben.
Abs.
Ben, you gay?
Yeah. Hey, good morning, boys. Happy birthday, Jimmy.
Hi, Ben.
All right, Ben, you're gay, so we're trying to figure this shit out. Like, if you guys are trying to get some real stuff done out there in the world, I can't imagine these parades make you happy.
No, you know what? I'm one of those rare type. I don't wear it like they do. I don't dress up. I don't.
You don't let your freak flag fly?
No. But you see. And personally, I have opposed. I have friends, and I argue with this point to them all the time. And I tell them, I said, you know, the more you be radical, the more you turn people against us. But they can't seem to get it. They don't get it. It's like they have to attack. They have to say, okay, no. They have to accept it. There's other ways to do it. They just it's a matter of education, really. I don't know.
It's going to be tough it's going to be tough to turn people around anyway, but it doesn't help matters when you're seeing the flamboyant out there.
That's what pride always accomplishes. It like gets all the people who already support it to rally behind it, but none of the people who don't support it turn around. So it doesn't really accomplish anything.
No, you're right. And I mean, and as much as I love, you know, twinks dressing up in women's clothing, you know, to go out in public, go shopping and stuff like that, just to what point and purpose? To annoy other people?
I mean, look at this guy. I don't mean to interrupt you, Ben, but we're looking at angel wings with the gay colors, the rainbow colors. It's like, come on.
There's a huge population of guys who dress up like as iconic superheroes, except shiny. like a lot of shiny Robins.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and like Batman, except without the full Batman costume, like just the underwear.
Not gay enough.
Just the underwear and belt and cape.
But how's he going to protect himself? How's the gay Batman going to protect himself?
I know, he doesn't have
with
the
all
rubber
that skin exposed.
Okay, I didn't see that.
There's no reason for that. It's Batman and Robin.
Without
their pants and like with crotchless chaps.
They have everything else on from the costume.
That's exactly, that's how the real Batman and Robin should have dressed. Oh. That's exactly how they should be dressed.
All right, Ben. Thank you for your phone call there.
Yeah.
Let me go to Stryker because he's got a very good question for Sam. Stryker.
Good morning, boys.
Hey.
You know, listening to Sam's description of the way these guys are dressed and the description you guys are giving of the way the pictures that Danny's pulling up are dressed, are you sure that he was at the Gay Pride Parade and not at a WWE event?
All right. It's very similar, Sam.
It's not similar.
It's very similar.
The tops, first of all, there's none of this going on at WWE.
Would
event.
Batman really be blowing Robin? Yeah, wouldn't Robin be blowing Batman?
That is just, that's pornography is what that is. But
yeah, why is
Batman blowing Robin?
And jerking himself off.
He's enjoying himself.
Are these outtakes from the Dark Knight?
Adam West complained because he wasn't asked to be in this photo shoot.
It doesn't matter what it is. If it's Batman, he's pissed.
Jesus,
it's not me.
Christ.
But no, there's nothing.
It wasn't a WWE event.
It didn't even somewhat resemble a WWE event.
No, not at all.
Didn't.
Was the ass man the
down, down.
Well, the ass man might have fit in a tiny bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Oh, it's going to get stuck in my head again.
If the Ass Man had a float and this song was pumping, he probably would be a hit at the Gay Pride Parade.
This song would fit. Like, they should have been playing this.
Yes, that is true.
Just listen to what they're doing with the ass.
Kick.
Shove them.
Stick them. Go to that saying.
Oh. Watch them.
Pick them.
Yeah.
Oh. No violence.
Because he's an Ass Man. Yeah. Who doesn't love the Ass Man song?
Yeah.
I've been singing it all week.
Now he's wrestling in front of 600 people in Jersey City.
Poor Ass Man. you saw him, huh?
I got to do play-by-play for one of his matches. That's where he's at in his career.
Oh, Sam's
I'm doing his play-by-play.
Play-by-play. I want to hear some...
What's the haps at the Gay Pride Parade with Sam?
Some of these guys talk. Now, Sam, you must have... were you getting looks?
I don't.
You are about a sweet little cupcake.
I appreciate the compliment.
Ooh.
But I go with my journalistic hat on, so I really have tunnel vision.
But your pants off, right?
No, my pants
works down.
Your pants weren't off?
My pants and belt were both on.
Ooh. But you were still official because you had the microphone.
I had a microphone.
And you had the hat that said press on the side, right?
Yes, I have tunnel vision. I do not pay attention. If there are any men looking at me sexually, I don't know. It's not something that I concentrate on.
When they
on.
Start kissing you.
I don't get kissed.
You should know then that they're looking at you sexually.
I don't get kissed at these events.
No?
No.
You kiss other men at other events that aren't even gay.
No, I do not. Well, I have, but I do not I don't as a practice.
There was a homeless guy. There was Bob Kelly. There was some other guy.
Sam's like a fucking four at the Gay Pride Parade. He's not exactly a sought-after twink. He's a very average gay guy.
Very average.
No, but you like just his thinness.
Average producer, too.
Well, no, I'm above average, I thought. But
well.
Damn. I mean, I guess you know better than me.
And then his hair is very original. Gay people would be like, ooh.
Yeah, they think he's messy.
I like to jizz in that.
He's got fucking stupid feet point out. He's got no hips.
I don't
Sam's
have
a
hips.
Four at the Gay Pride Parade.
Wow. Very flat ass.
Yeah, flat ass and
really?
Hipless.
Very, yeah.
Nice neck. Sam has a nice long swan neck.
Ah,
thank you,
good.
Jim.
Yeah, Sam's neck is his sexiest feature.
All the better to pump jizz down.
Okay, well, hopefully not. I want to kiss more guys.
That's really?
That's not live content. That is pre-taped material.
Chuck G from Charlotte writes, I worked as an electrician on Cape Cod several years back and have done some work in Provincetown and have found that every summer there's one gentleman that would ride his bike down Commercial Street in nothing but a pair of Black Angel wings.
And then he writes, the wings.
And then he writes, dot, 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 ick.
What is with the angel wings?
Angel wings are just such a festive piece.
Like, as far as the Bible's concerned, it's the only way they'll ever have them.
There was a group with signs that said,
because, you know,
going to go to hell because of the Catholic Church.
Hey,
and
was Bobo there fighting for the right to fuck his brother?
No, Bobo was actually, I've heard, there is a rumor he was having sex with his brother and didn't make it to Pride.
Oh, Pride. You just call it Pride.
Pride, that's what it is.
Ah, right.
We told Bobo he
say happy Pride.
I didn't know that.
Bobo needs a new bid. We told him the Bobo Springsteen is officially dead.
He Twittered it, by the way. He said that his bit is officially dead.
Good.
And, but he said, I have a bunch of new material I'm coming up with.
He's
rehearsing.
New material.
You know he's rehearsing.
I actually heard that he records himself having sex with his brother and just brings in the audio.
Oh, oh I can't wait.
It happens a lot, so.
All right, whatever. Here we go. Sam starts with Daniel, right?
Yeah, Daniel just had a he just kept laughing, and I just
Daniel.
I just thought his giggle was infectious.
Yeah.
All right, we're here with Daniel at the Gay Pride Parade. Daniel, what's the haps?
Nothing much.
What are you doing here today?
I'm just looking around, you know, looking at everything, just having fun.
How is the gay community dealing with the loss of infomercial king Billy Mays?
I don't really know who that is.
He's the guy, he's on Pitchman, and he yells at the TV. He's on all the infomercials. He's got a beard.
Oh, is he the one from, like, the ShamWow or something?
No, but he's like that guy.
Oh, I don't know who that is.
He's dead.
Oh, he died?
Yeah.
That's sad. I don't really know who that is, though.
Well, you sound pretty broken up. Thanks a lot.
I'm sorry.
Is the parade backing up into his ass every time you ask him a question?
Holy shit. That could possibly be the gayest voice I've ever heard in my life.
He had this kid, he was fully dressed, but he was wearing shorts and a t-shirt. I know. He had shorts and a t-shirt on and had rainbow socks pulled all the way up, so it almost looked like leggings.
That's cute.
The rainbow is a symbol for pride. I don't know if you guys knew that.
Yeah, we know that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
How annoyed is Jesse Jackson that he fucking calls this thing the Rainbow Coalition?
Rainbow Coalition.
2 hours later, the gays take the same thing.
We meet Benjamin.
Oh, yeah. Benjamin was selling Obama condoms.
Really?
He was standing on the corner with a box and yelling out Obama condoms.
What are Obama condoms? Like, what's the difference between that and a regular
When you
condom?
Fuck somebody and you pull your dick out and a lot of your hard-earned money is stuck to it.
Well, he was having no luck selling because people kept walking up. Because people give things out of pride. And people kept walking up and saying, oh, cool. And every time they'd pick one up, he'd say, no, it's 3 for $10. And then they put it back down. But I wanted to find out what an Obama condom was. So some of his puns, I think, since this is a comedy show, you guys will all just kind of really kind of like
that, Sam. Hey, Sam, who'd you go down there with?
My girlfriend, Jess, who's a girl. And we're out here at the Gay Pride Parade with Benjamin. Benjamin, what's the haps?
The what?
The haps?
The haps. Well, we're selling Obama condoms for everybody's hard times. They're actually curved to the left and flavored with...
Oh, my God. Here come the
hard
puns.
Hard times,
see?
Curved to the left.
Oh,
right.
Here come the puns.
And flavored with, what do you think? Chocolate?
No.
I would think because he's, an African-American gentleman.
Oh, wow.
Flavored with.
Can you ring the bell for every pun?
Oh, please.
There's got to be something with package and stimulus.
Yes, yes.
Oh, yeah. You got
you guys
a package.
Heard this clip before?
Stimulus. Uh-oh. Very good.
Down the throats of the American people? No.
No, he's a supporter of Obama.
What do you think it's flavored with?
Yeah, that's the thing.
Maybe it's not a traditional flavor. Maybe it's just that's how wacky and fun it is.
Does it sound kind of like a flavor?
Maybe
a
not even. It's just so, like, crazy and wacky that it's like, how could... That's not even a real flavor.
Flavored with shit?
Flavored with change?
You're getting close.
I know.
Ew!
I know it has something to do with change. Flavored with...
What's the other tag word? Change and...
Yes, we can. It was flavored in someone's can.
Change in what? I don't know.
Well, I mean...
I don't feel like playing fucking password right now. Give me the fucking answer.
We could just listen to the
clip. Oh, my God. No, it's not flavored with that. Flavored with... is what some people are writing.
It's not even...
That's not even
doesn't even make sense.
Let's find out.
That's crazy.
And we'll ring the bell every time there's a pun. Okay.
We're out here at the Gay Pride Parade with Benjamin. Benjamin, what's the haps?
The what?
The haps?
The haps. Well, we're selling Obama condoms for everybody's hard times. They're actually curved to the left and flavored with hope.
Oh,
Is Obama curved to the left, or is that just like a joke about his...
Well, no, the condoms are actually curved to the left in scientific studies. They tend to go to the left, more to the right. Lately, we found that they've been moving towards center.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I get it, because of his policies.
Oh, you're catching on there.
Yes. Do you think this is something Obama would be proud of?
Oh, definitely. He's a fan of entrepreneurship. He's a fan of safety. He's a fan of hope. He's a fan of judgment. And most importantly, the stimulus package.
Oh, the stimulus because of the, like, boners.
Obama condom.
He got tired of me. What makes an Obama condom different from, like, a regular condom?
They're actually hope-flavored and lubed with hope as well.
What does hope taste like?
Surprisingly like latex.
Oh, I see. Well, best of luck to you.
Thank you, brother.
He got really sick of me. That's why I started trying to sell the condoms.
He's just turning around. You're fucking, you know, you're fucking his business.
That music will give you a fucking headache.
Oh, it was all over. It was not escapable.
Just pounding. Boom, boom,
couldn't be on Fifth Avenue without some nice...
Boom, boom, boom.
Oh, I wish this song was playing.
At least the boom in this song is softer.
You know what I mean? Boom, boom.
All right, let's... Oh, you mean Anthony at the game, right?
Yeah, Anthony was there.
Oh, damn
Anthony.
It. Now, Sam, I saw said you. This was off the record. Oh, no.
Who is the party, he says? We meet Anthony, who is the party and represents gay people well.
Yes.
All right, we're here with Anthony at the Gay Pride Parade. Anthony, what's the haps?
Well, right now, I'm very upset because they refused to play Kelly Clarkson, I Do Not Hook Up. But, you know, everything else is good. But I'm enjoying myself. This is my first time going to Pride here in New York. So right now, it's kind of fun. I'm the party right now.
You are the party?
Yes, I'm the party.
Cool.
Yes.
Sloppy party.
How do you
bottom.
Feel? There's a lot of controversy with Sacha Baron Cohen's new movie, Bruno, about it playing on stereotypes and stuff. Do you think there's problems with the way people view gays as like an oversexed...
Yes. In a way, there it is.
Where do you think that people get those ideas from?
From... certain movies that they show on television, in a way, they don't show exactly what gays go through. They make it seem like we're all about the nightlife, doing drugs and everything. That's not what it's really about.
Do you think the Pride Parade with the men dancing around in their underwear and stuff on the floats and partying adds or detracts from that?
Well, it's a gay Pride Parade. Like, you're supposed to, like, go all out and have fun, because... it's only one day out of the year where you actually get to be yourself.
That's what gay guys do, right?
Exactly.
There you go.
You just made him turn the whole thing around.
I love it.
That's what gay guys do. Exactly.
Exactly.
Oh, wait a minute. I just said no. We don't do that.
Jesus.
Oh, he was boy. The party, though.
You can twist people around.
Well, I mean, it's, you know.
You were just playing him.
Of course I was.
Oh, God.
Like this guy.
He's in a pink little skirt.
You're telling me that guy's not an idiot?
With a pink flower laying in the street.
Sneakers.
Sneakers on and...
some type of...
Jesus.
Tutu or...
can't imagine.
Wow. Anthony continues, talks about losing Billy Mays.
Well, because I just, while I was at Pride, it was on Sunday, so I just had gotten an email that Billy Mays had passed away.
How many career homers did he end up with?
No, that's not the same guy.
Oh,
Billy Mays is the
fuck.
Infomercial guy.
God, I can't get this right today.
How is the gay community dealing with the loss of infomercial king Billy Mays?
Ooh. Right. Honestly, I'm not sure.
He's the guy from the infomercials. He has the beard and he yells a lot. OxyClean.
Oh, him.
Yeah, he's dead.
What about him?
He's dead.
I don't know about that. I didn't know he died.
Yeah, that's why I was trying to see how people are reacting. He died just today.
Oh, my God. I did not know that at all.
Were you a fan?
I liked the commercial. Honestly, I thought it was funny because he made it seem like it was the cure for everything.
Yeah.
So I liked it. It seemed very good to me.
Had your hopes up, didn't you?
All right, well, great. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Him and his friend just guzzling fucking oxy whatever it's called.
OxyClean.
OxyClean.
Hi, I'm Billy Maids.
Oh, you. We meet Eric, who
Iraq was there too. Cool.
Yes,
who's wearing underpants and rollerblades.
Eric was great because he was he was very muscular, very in good shape, clean cut, and just underpants on, just green and orange underpants and rollerblades.
Jesus. Doesn't seem very safe. Like you could maybe scuff a knee or
something.
Where
the fuck does he keep his money there, Sam?
Yeah, he
needs a drink or a little lunch or something.
I bet it stinks when he pays.
Yes.
Let me grab into my wallet.
It's one of those old cigar holders, plastic.
Oh, Jesus.
Puts it in there and pounds it in with a mallet.
All right, I'm ready for a day of rollerblading.
Got to give the guy a Heimlich if you want change. Creepy. So where does he keep his money, Sam?
He was holding his cell phone. So his money must be kept inside the underpants. There must be some kind of pocket. They were very tight, so I wouldn't assume that anything would slip out.
Mm. All right, we're out here with Eric at the Gay Pride Parade. Eric, what's the haps?
I'm with Naked Boys Singing.
So is this why today you're in the underwear and rollerblades?
Yes, our signature colors are lime green and sherbet orange. And I'm rollerblading because it's nice to be able to zip back and forth and say hi to all my friends and... I can be my own personal float.
Do you think one of the problems politically with the way people are dealing with gays in the media and other places is the stereotypes that they have about gays being oversexed and things like that?
Yeah, I think they do that a lot. You know, any coverage of the parades, they always show the most outlandish, you know, person or float in the parade, which, you know, is a demographic of the community, but it doesn't represent the community as a whole.
Would you put yourself in that outlandish category?
Oh, I think I kind of like the best of both worlds. I can, like, be fun and outlandish, but I can also sort of reel it in and, you know, be a professional.
So in your day-to-day life, you do wear pants?
I do wear pants.
I do.
Good question, though.
Yeah. But he said, like, if it's such a problem that people are concentrating too much on the outlandish people.
Put your pants on.
Put your pants on,
really. Put your pants on.
You could wear a tank top.
Right,
it's not that warm.
Yeah, come on.
Put your pants on, get some things done, and then go back to wearing the underpants.
Right. If you want to skate around in your underpants at home, that's one thing.
That is something that they just say, like, that is
it's a problem.
Yeah, it's a problem. As he's naked.
He continues.
How is the gay community reacting to the loss of infomercial king Billy Mays?
Of what?
Of the loss of infomercial king Billy Mays. He passed away.
Okay, who is he, first of all?
He's the guy from the infomercials. He had
Whammo?
Maybe Whammo. He sold OxyClean. He had the beard.
Bearded?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so sad. I didn't know he was gay, just because I'm like,
gay.
You never know who's gay and who's not sometimes.
I didn't know he was gay either.
That makes me sad. I just found out that from you. But it makes me sad when anyone passes away. But, that you know, life ebbs and flows. You know what I mean? People come and people go. And
hopefully the soul of Billy Mays is now being put into a newborn.
I know. Didn't he say, like, whammo? I know he just screamed a lot.
Yeah. He got his point across, though.
He did.
Why is that funny?
He did. I don't know. For some reason, it just tickled me that he said, I didn't know he was gay. Yeah, nobody said he was.
Did his ball bag jiggle when he laughed like that?
I didn't look at the ball bag. I make eye contact.
What kind of fucking reporter are you?
Did Billy Mays say whammo?
I don't know. He said, like,
kaboom. Yeah, he was probably thinking of kaboom.
Yeah, he was the kaboom guy.
No whammo. It's very generic to say whammo.
Wait, didn't Billy Mays say, "You're no son of mine, get the fuck out of my house"? No, that must have been someone else.
I think he said booyah.
But there will be a video of this posted later this week.
Oh, we can't wait, Sam.
So you guys can see Eric in his underpants in all his glory.
Oh.
And when I was looking at the video that I had my girlfriend, Jess, who accompanied me to the parade, take...
Girlfriend. Right.
She did a kind of like a wide shot, so Eric's package was in frame throughout the interview.
Oh, good.
Yes. So
did she enjoy the packages?
I think not.
Why wouldn't she?
Because they're very gay. They're gay packages.
How would that work with a girl for real?
They're still men.
Doesn't matter.
But they're not
manly.
Does
the girl enjoy the gay package? Like just watching it and admiring it? And
girls would admire the shape that these guys are in.
Yeah.
Regardless of their sexual orientation. It would be like having a chick that is really hot but is a lesbian. A guy would enjoy looking at her.
But Jess doesn't really like guys that are in shape like that.
She doesn't like guys?
No, that are in shape like that. She prefers like skinny, like...
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No, I like ass. The fact that Jake LaMotta here just pointed out that they weren't... They're not very masculine.
Well, no. remember we were talking about Obama. This is a quickie before the break. Obama, thank you, Sam. That was really
good. You're welcome.
Good. You did all right.
Yes. Dude.
Thank you.
I know it was a tough assignment for you.
It was. Why are you saying that sarcastically as if I enjoyed it?
It's going to be hard
probably
to report
a
with
going
a raging
there, right?
Hard-on.
First of all, I didn't have a hard-on.
He had to actually fucking rubber band his dick to the fucking thigh so it wouldn't seem unprofessional.
None of that's true, but I don't... Danny just looked up
goodness.
The word... Twinks in Google Images.
Well, you told Danny to show
pictures. Look at those two just taking a bath together.
It's not a worry in the world.
Just sucking each other's dicks. Right.
They're not worried about a Ponzi scheme.
No.
They don't give a shit. Here's Obama, a quickie from Obama. He was talking and some shit happened.
For we know that progress depends not only on changing laws, but also changing hearts. Yes. And that real transformative change never begins in Washington. Who's duck back there?
It's a duck.
There's a duck quacking in there somewhere. Where do you guys get these ringtones, by the way? I'm just curious. Indeed, that's the story of the movement for fairness and equality.
Wow. He goes right back
then
to it.
He goes
too
right
quickly.
Back to it. He got a laugh.
I was enjoying the dumb little moment, but then he couldn't let it just play out.
He got a laugh. He's kind of
right.
Naturally funny when it comes to things like
yeah.
that. Like, he's pretty good when he's giving a speech if something happens, like to, unless it's serious. You know, some kind of serious thing, him trying to think on his feet. But for a good goof, yeah, he's pretty funny.
All right, we're going to take a break. Is Sean William Scott coming in today? For real?
Yeah, he's supposed to be coming in
20 minutes.
Fucking hey, did you see him on set yesterday, Jimmy?
He's
in that movie, too.
He's got a big part in the movie and a fucking really funny part.
I think Kevin Smith has a hit on his hands. You got Bruce, you got Tracy, you got Sean William Scott.
You got Adrian Brody, Kevin Pollak played two cops.
Jim Norton.
Old Jimmy Norton.
Yeah, who knows? You know, somebody in the room may make it into the trailer. We just don't know yet.
Whoa.
Is that what they're saying?
I don't know. Just a line that the guys might have had. Who knows? I don't know.
The big catchphrase line or
maybe.
Something?
Maybe.
You know how many people see trailers, Jimmy?
That'd be
holy fuck.
Perhaps Mortimer.
That would be huge.
Well, I don't even know. They'd probably just show those two, but...
I hate tags. Anyone have a fucking thing I could cut this goddamn tag off?
That'd be so funny
nuts.
If it's just the top of your sweaty head with Bruce Willis's hand on it and Bruce Willis.
Jimmy's saying he had a line that might just...
Well, it was actually them saying it, but... Do you know how embarrassed I was when he asked me to dry my fucking forehead?
Dry your... fucking sweaty head.
Sorry, there's an icon slipping off my greasy, nervous head. Fucking asshole. Yeah. My fucking head was all greasy and nervous.
It's funny.
I'm acting.
Yeah. It's so goddamn funny.
All right. So he's coming in, what, 10?
Yes.
Ooh. Well, we're leaving at 10:05, so it'll be a quick fucking...
quick interview.
All right.
Maybe we'll trade Bruce stories.
Ooh.
A couple of co-stars.
Nice.
Bruce stories.
Why not? All right, we'll continue. Jimmy. Opie and Anthony. Sam's got to come back in here. We were done with him, but he just gave us some knowledge.
One more fun
Sam,
tidbits.
We got to talk about this on the air. Okay. What the hell has been going on for the last 3 hours down the hall?
Well, we all remember on the show when Anthony said... to go with this green flag and red flag, you needed a yellow flag, right? Everybody remembers that, right?
Yep.
Here's what I actually said. We have a paddle. On one side is green. On the other side is red.
That's a bad green, by the way, on the paddle.
Yeah, well, it's kind of faded. Now it's like a brownish olive thing.
Yeah.
But I think we know. Green, red. But it's just flat, like a paddle.
E-Rock is coming down the hall, which means he wants in.
Oh, he wants
in.
Smiling.
He's smiling
away.
I love E-Rock.
He gets
a lot of abuse, but I love this part of E-Rock.
Oh, yeah. This is great.
He can't wait to get involved. Go ahead, Ann. Sorry.
See, now I was thinking a three-sided paddle.
Yeah.
which is, you know, you open up this and then you add in another yellow panel, thus making a triangle.
Right.
And then fasten the handle to the triangle. That way I could turn one handle yellow, green, red.
Now, when you said
on what's being said,
it was of the utmost importance, needed to get done ASAP, correct?
No, actually, I forgot about it seconds after I said it. Oh. Never expected the yellow. Okay. I think if I just say, oh, yellow flag, it was, I think that's good. And this is radio.
It was
right.
It was an afterthought. So, it really was an afterthought. Like, that would be kind of funny if we had a yellow side too, but whatever. That's
though
stupid.
I do hold
in
up
the end, that's stupid.
The paddle. Right. It is indeed radio. So
right.
I could say yellow.
So what happened, Sam?
Unfortunately, one member of our staff heard you say yellow flag and then shut down everything else.
E-Rock is nodding. Steve, everything has been shut down.
Steve is back to work today.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Steve is. Well, Steve is here in the building today.
All right.
And,
oh, so we were off by that sick day by one day because we were convinced he was setting up for the sick day on Friday, but then he tricked everybody and took the personal day on Monday.
Yeah. No, sick day.
He took a sick day.
Sick day on Monday. Yes.
We were joking that he was setting up for the sick day for Friday.
With all the medication.
But he ended up taking the sick day yesterday.
Sick day yesterday, yes.
And God damn it, I didn't even know.
We noted
and
also, slowly there was like, I don't think Jimmy was here for this. We noted slowly that on his desk and things, certain cold medications were showing up.
He was literally
like
setting up for a
spot,
sick day.
So it's all right, he's kind of gearing up.
So like if he calls in, people would go, he called in, they'd go, yeah, but I did see the medicine on the desk.
I saw the medicine there.
Oh, it's textbook shit.
It was calling in sick in the first degree.
So,
Steve, come in, please. He should be here to defend himself.
So basically, Steve, first, about 2 hours ago, said, all right, Sam, what do you think of this for a yellow flag? A yellow handkerchief tied to a Super Bowl.
Did he mean for the march on Sunday?
E-Rock is chomping at the bit, and he doesn't have any food in his mouth. So
let the horse hit the mic then.
And I said,
chomping at the... I'm teasing, of course, E-Rock.
And I said, why? No. What? And he said, you know, like when you throw in the yellow flag.
Oh.
And I said, we're talking about the flag. And I said, no, not like a yellow flag like in sports. Like on his paddle, you know, we do that thing that says green, yellow.
Yeah.
Oh, he said. And then I noticed during the break, he came in and looked at your paddle.
Yes.
To figure out what it was.
Yeah.
D-Rock?
No, finish and then I'll tell you what else happened.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no.
And now there is a yellow paddle.
A yellow paddle.
Which is completely separate now, which kind of.
An intern has been assembling a yellow paddle.
For how long?
I don't know, but I believe there was a trip made to get yellow construction paper. Two trips. I'm being told.
There's the yellow paddle outside the studio.
So,
that's
I mean,
big paddle.
Bring it in. Standing outside with it.
So here's the final product. The yellow paddle that'll never be used.
Yellow paddle.
Sorry.
So guys, I mean, if you guys reach a point where you might have to stop soon, but are okay. You're pretty
you
much
got to
covered.
Slow down a little bit.
Yeah.
There's the yellow
you don't
paddle.
Necessarily have to stop.
Which
just
is
be
very
aware
big
that it might be dangerous
bulky.
To yeah. keep
like
your speed up.
A ruler good. Was actually obviously purchased.
Yes, I see a new ruler, a regular your standard school 12-inch mm-hmm. mm-hmm. ruler mm-hmm. was some purchased.
Money went into this as well.
E-Rock, what do you got to add to this?
Well, hold on, did somebody say that I want a yellow paddle that's visible from Google Earth?
No.
Why so large?
Giant like
We're going to find out all that. E-Rock, what do you got?
Bigger than.
Well, to back up a little bit on this, this was one of those times to take advantage to the fact that Steve wasn't listening to the show. So,
oh, Steve.
So when they. when you made this slight mention, I knew he wasn't paying attention. I go, Steve, did you hear that? And he said, what? I said, they're asking you in the back, do they need a yellow flag? Right? And he goes, oh. And so I explained to him, I said, you know, the red and green one, they need something, you know, a yellow flag. Maybe like one of the ones that they use at soccer and football that they throw into the middle of the console so they know to calm down. So he started developing the ball and the sheet and the rubber band thing. And then This wasn't working. I guess this is where Sam got involved.
Absolutely, that would be a terrible idea.
And then there was plans, different trips for construction paper, for staples, for a ruler, how this was all going to lay out. This has been going on for almost 3 hours.
Jesus.
Has this paddle been going on for 3 hours? Come on now. Be honest.
Noah?
Well, the entire process.
Well, there's a microphone there.
Yeah. The whole process was about 3 hours.
Mic's not on.
3 hours to get a dumb yellow paddle that we're never going to use?
For this!
See, I'm just the opposite. I'm thinking only 3 hours? Wow. You work fast.
Like, why 3 hours? Because you had to go out and get the materials?
Yeah, it was all... It was from nothing.
Oh, it was from nothing.
Right.
Wow.
Most things are
from nothing.
Created from nothing.
It's just like watching how it's made. It's fantastic.
Believe it or not, that's all that is a ruler, a piece of yellow construction paper, and some staples.
Right. There, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 staples.
Dude, a kid in kindergarten could have made this in 10 minutes.
Slightly better.
Earl could have made this quicker, and we know about Earl.
Yeah. Earl. Wait, what do you
I don't understand 3 hours.
Hey, which is why we got an EP, you know what I'm saying?
What do you got there, Steve, on this paddle thing?
Yes, on the paddle.
And how long did we really spend on this?
You know what? I should really step back because whatever Sam says is completely unfabricated, 100% accurate, so you might
as well. The guy in the hat is E-Rock.
It's sarcasm, I think.
No, and Eric is completely accurate as well, so you know what?
Really?
Yeah, oh my God. Everything, there is 100% veracity behind everything those two say.
Sean?
So.
Hey, Sean William Scott.
Man.
And now we go with Sean.
I saw you.
Oh.
Did you see me?
I saw you.
The cellar 2 days ago.
Oh, no.
I was fucking there, man.
Oh, no, I didn't see you. I
swear.
Cool, yeah.
Okay, cool.
How's
up, Sean? How
good
are
you, buddy?
Good
to see you guys, man.
Good to see you.
I'm so sorry. I totally interrupted you.
That's right.
No.
I saw you, trust me.
It was filler because we knew you were downstairs.
Oh,
so we were beating up the staff a little bit. We're doing good.
Good.
Kevin Smith has been coming in a lot, and I'm like, will you get fucking Sean William Scott in here? Because he loves the show.
I'm sorry. He's a champion because that one day we worked until 6.
Oh, my God,
and he came in. I was like, you're fucking awesome.
We told him.
The movie is sick.
I'm hearing. 2 dicks.
It's fucking... telling my mom. She's like, I go, she goes, how you doing? I go, I'm so fucking excited about a couple of dicks. And my mom's like, whoa, I'm sorry. I go, it's a fucking movie, mom. What are you talking about? She's like, okay. And I keep thinking like how awesome it's going to be when kids like go to school like on Monday and go, man, I surely loved a couple of dicks.
Yeah. Like, I saw a couple of dicks over the weekend.
Yeah, exactly. Are they going to keep the title of the movie?
You know how Hollywood is, man. Right?
I mean, I hope so too. That would be
the
great.
The paper put a couple of cops.
Yeah.
Was that the original title? Or
no, it was always a couple of dicks, but I think that they're.
They better not fuck with that title. That's a good title.
Dude, he's fucking funny, man. Like on set, we'll do shit and like he'll throw stuff out and he's really. Because I worked with him on Jay and Silent Bob for that one scene. Mm-hmm. He's funny as shit, man. Like, he's
that
really...
Dog
Tracy
the
Morgan.
Braces in the guitar.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
You remember that?
I'm fucking thinking. I'm
that's
like,
awesome.
Yeah, you're in the van with the guy singing those stupid
Jay
songs.
Jay Muse is funny, too. I mean, he's not in this movie, like, when I worked with him then, I was like, that dude needs to work more because he's really funny. What's going on, guys?
Well,
how you been?
Let's back up a little bit. The last time you were in here, I think you were promoting Role Models, right?
Yeah, I think
so, finally
yeah.
fucking saw that movie 2 months ago.
Yeah.
God damn, is that a good movie.
Oh, cool.
I think more people should have saw that movie.
Yeah, well,
and
I'm
it's
glad
on demand
it.
Right now, so, you know, I'm sure the money will trickle down to you if someone pops it up on the
DVR. Exactly.
On demand or whatever.
I'll take it.
That little black kid is a superstar too.
He is. He's like a little Eddie Murphy.
Right.
Like, you know, I always, because he had to kind of stick to the script because they always had like a, what are they, like a handler, you know, like he's a little young kid.
Yeah.
And so the director couldn't tell him, you know, to swear more. So I would be like, dude, tell me to fuck off.
Yeah.
And so he's like, cool, really? I'm like, yeah, fuck it. And so you tell me, he's like, fuck you, man. I'm like, yeah. There's nothing better than hearing a little like 10-year-old tell me to fuck off slap me.
You're right. He's like a mini old school Eddie Murphy
type
kid. And the movie was great. And I remember you came
Thanks,
in.
Bro.
I think you might have been promoting Mr. Woodcock. And you're,
sorry.
And you're like, no. But I would love to pull a tape because I think he even said, fuck that movie. I really want to talk about this Role Models that I also
did. Awesome.
And then finally the movie came out and I saw it. I was like, right on.
Oh, I'm glad you dug it, dude.
You're a funny motherfucker, bro.
There's nothing better. Thanks, dude. I mean, I think the only thing that makes my character funny and Role Models is the first scene where I just come out and I stick my fingers up to Paul Rudd's face. I go, guess what I did last night? And it's like right away, you know, this guy is just one of the dudes. You know?
And they always say it's tough to, you know, act with kids and stuff because they show you up. But yeah. No, you were right in there.
That's big awesome. Time. Yeah. Thanks, man.
How was Billy Bob Thornton? Was he difficult? Because we saw that here, the interview that he did where he was like a
right?
total dick. And it's like, is he like that on the set or is
not
he okay?
at all, dude. Oh, okay. I saw that too. And I was fucking shocked because he was.
He was in a bad mood that day.
He must have been, man. Like, I don't know. Because like, he was always so cool, man. So down to earth. We would rip on that Woodcock. Yeah. I think I told you. We'd watch like, what was it? We would watch American Idol when Carrie Underwood was on. We're like, we want to fuck her so bad. and we knew we'd never meet her. And he was totally chill, but we'd rip on Woodcock. We're like, this movie fucking sucks. Like, it's so bad.
When you were ripping on it when you were filming it?
Totally,
you
dude.
Just knew, right?
Oh, yeah.
See,
we're
I
like,
love
it's
your
so
honesty.
Sad, man. It's so, and there's nothing worse than going to a movie set knowing that this could end my career. You know what I mean? Like, I can't afford to make mistakes. I'm not Vince Vaughn. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just like, holy shit, I might be going back to Home Depot.
Yeah.
And like, but he was totally cool. And so when I saw that interview or I heard the interview, I was like, that's not him, man. He's I mean, have you had him on the show?
No, unfortunately not.
He's actually, love he's cool.
Oh, he wouldn't have.
Something must have happened before.
Like, he wouldn't have got away with that shit on our show. But
yeah, no. Yeah, that's true.
We would have had a war.
You never know, though. You might have had fucking,
well,
you know.
Well, what happened recently with his daughter? Or
yeah, yeah. Little, something with his daughter was convicted of murder.
A little murder.
What? Billy Bob Thornton's daughter?
Oh, yeah. It's a big story, man.
It's a strange story. I mean, I don't even know, like, I mean, but it says in the news, his daughter was like, man, that's so fucked. You know, I was going to call him.
Little murder. So.
What? How the fuck did I not hear this?
It's everywhere.
Is this today?
No, it's been.
It was a while ago.
Yeah. The last couple weeks.
You ever see that outtake with him and John Cusack sitting at the fucking table when they were making that movie? What was it called?
Oh,
Ice
Bandits?
Something?
No, not Bandits. No, it's the one with the Air Force.
And
airplane
he just goes
stuff,
into
right?
Carl from fucking.
I think it's called the Ice
no
Harvest.
No way, really?
Dude, it's yeah. so it's fucking really funny, man.
That's awesome.
It's great.
I haven't seen that. That does it,
like it doesn't, it doesn't seem like he would just break in and doing that, especially so many years after actually doing it. But then to do it and to see him as Billy Bob, not as Carl doing it, you almost forget that he did it in the first place. You're like, well, he did a really here it is. Pop that up a little bit.
Oh no way! It's an outtake of this.
Yeah, that's you got awesome. That. It's really
this is cool. Holy shit, look at him. His face totally changes.
He does it.
Oh, sorry, bro.
Who's that on the phone?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Carl?
Well, it ain't like it's none of your fucking business. That's my wife on the phone. Lovely Gladys.
Look at John Cusack, so uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Big old fat girl.
Oh, my God. Yeah. His face totally changes.
No, I ain't having dinner with her. Hell no. She had enough dinner in her lifetime. Like I said, she's a big old fat gal. She eats over at the Subway like that boy in them TV commercials.
Jared?
She has I reckon that's his name. She has a couple of meatball sandwiches at lunchtime, then around dinner time she'll have two or three more. Yeah. Then, of course, she comes back out the house after she bought her a new dress or two off of Omar, the tent maker.
Yep.
Yeah. That is awesome, dude.
Nice to say.
Well, if you had to live with the son of a bitch, you might not say that. Now let me out of here.
Sure.
Yeah.
Want some more of that creme brulee?
No. Why don't you eat you some of that pudding that's good for you?
Oh, my gosh, dude. That's classic.
Grace Kennedy smiles and walks away.
Dude.
Isn't that great?
He is, see, that's who he is, man. He's funny as shit.
That's
like,
fucking funny, man.
That is
man.
Awesome. He is fucking hilarious.
When you forget it's him because it looks nothing like him. Like, I watch Sling Blade and just go like, that isn't Billy Bob Thornton.
No. Yeah,
it's just not
crazy.
Him. And then when you see him like that and he completely puts the face
funny,
on
man.
And the voice, you're like, wow.
You know what I watched crazy. The other day? I mean, I'm like, it is amazing. That's like literally like I saw the thing with him and that interview. I was like, that's fucking he's funny as shit. Like, you know, they made him seem like such a dick, but he's not. He's awesome. But like I saw that I rewatched the clip with who's the director with Lily Tomlin?
And,
oh, that's so good, man. Yeah. You fucking bitch! Right. I've been working on this fucking movie for... And he fucking, like, calls her a cunt.
Right.
You cunt! And you're like, Lily Tomlin, all right, sure, just go sabotage your movie. You fucking bitch! And it's so amazing. He's, like, hitting shit. And I love the clip before when he's in the car.
Yeah,
and,
yep.
And like, and Dustin's in the middle, Lily's, and then I think Naomi Watts is in the back, and then Lily Tomlin looks to Dustin, is like, "Fuck you too, you motherfucker!" Amazing, dude. Don't you wish you could have been on that set?
Yeah, like, just my God,
like, that we love, I mean, that clip.
Amazing. One of the best scenes in that clip is when he walks out the door, and it's just a set. But he walks out the door and then comes back.
You hear him still yelling in the
camera.
Yeah. He comes in the other door and you hear like, "You motherfucker!"
He like slammed the door for effect. Yeah. So then he walks back around.
The whole set is shaking from him slamming the door.
And I love the ADs like ushering people out. Right. You know, he's like, "Okay, just go.
Okay, this is bad."
Oh, man.
Elizabeth wants to ask you something. Elizabeth in Philly. Elizabeth.
Hey guys. Hey. Happy birthday, Jimmy.
Thank you, madam.
Jimmy's birthday. Shut up.
So why don't you tell us all about how you banged Jessica Simpson?
Oh, Jesus.
Wait, what was that?
She wants to know how you... She said, can you tell us how you banged Jessica Simpson?
Oh, yeah, God. You mentioned it on another radio show, and you've been in to promote all these movies and then not mention it to O&A.
I wish it was the truth.
That's unfair.
No, I did say that, but I was like... I went on a radio station.
It was Who Kid.
Who's
right across the hall. He comes on our show, and we're like, yeah, we're good friends with Sean William Scott. He goes, oh, yeah, how good of friends are you? You with him. He admitted on our show that he banged Jessica Simpson. I'm like, that motherfucker.
Dude, that's not even true, that fucker. I was like, I said to him, he goes, I heard Nick Lachey is mad at you. I go, why? Because I fucked his wife.
Oh,
and then I was joking. And then I added to it afterwards. I'm like, no, I didn't fuck his wife. But they didn't put that on there. It was on like IMDb thing. Sean William Scott says he fucks Jessica Simpson.
It's not a bad rumor to have.
No, I mean, that's kind of why I said it. I'm trying to spread as many of those as possible.
And you told the Steve Martin story on our show.
Yeah, I think
so. Because everyone's asking you to retell that. But
it's weird, right, dude? Like, that was, you've had him on?
No.
You know him, right?
I've met him one time briefly. And
what was he like?
He was walking by. I got a photo with him. He had the same face he has on the Cheaper Than a Dozen. Fucking Cheaper Than a Dozen poster.
Yeah, dude.
That stupid
he
squint.
He fucking hated me, man. Yeah.
That Pink Panther 2 was on the plane. I was flying, and Pink Panther 2 was on. And I got to be honest. I mean, it really, a couple of good laughs. I was actually hoping that was an Air France flight. I was so fucking disgusted.
Ugh. Dude, you were hilarious the other night, man. I came in, like, in the middle of your show. I didn't know what you were playing, but we just, like, randomly went in there. You're hilarious.
Oh, thanks, man.
I was like, hey! I was the asshole in the back trying to get your attention.
Oh, dude, I really
didn't put the lights on. No, dude.
Did
but that was
have
the dick.
That man removed. They
put me in the corner with some cold french fries, just, like, feed him something.
Comedy Cellar, obviously.
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Oh, let me know next time you're going.
Totally,
that's
dude.
The place.
I don't even know why you're here, because you don't have to promote Ice Age 3. This is a monster movie.
I'm whoring out for an animated movie, dude.
Isn't that amazing?
You don't have to promote this.
You're talking about money trickling in. That Ice Age money fucking pours in like a dump
truck. How good is that money?
Dude. I haven't seen it yet.
Wait,
but like,
you weren't in
a little bit though. I mean,
were you in one and two? No, right?
I was in the second one.
Second
but I bet
one,
you like. Well, I'm guessing like you know in the Shrek movies, those guys made like $10 million.
Yeah.
On the second one, so maybe like Ray Romano and Dennis Leary and those guys got a ton. But I did it for my nephew that when I did the second one, and then I watched. I was like, "Fuck, man, this is my best performance animated." You know, it's like this is so sad. So I did the third one, and I was like, "Maybe I'll make some cash."
How is that to do? Is it like easy work? Relatively
speaking. I mean, it's I'm not putting out oil fires, you know, but
they just gotta like.
But it's kind of stressful, dude. It's kind of like. I mean, it's not stressful, but like you literally are out there with your dick out, pretty much, because you don't have another actor out there, and then you just have to act like an asshole. But I've done that quite a bit in films. So.
What do they do? Kind of give you a picture and go, here's what your character is going to look like.
Pretty much. And now, then you just read lines and you just have to act like an ass.
Did you have to put on a wacky voice or could you just use your voice?
Kind of. Well, the same voice that I've done in every other film, which is pretty much like Captain Asshole. So what's new, man? So what girls you been banging?
Oh, man.
I got to hear about
this. I don't know. I'm just trying to stay away from any felonies. It's pretty much all I try to do these days, but
any scandals?
Well, no big scandals and stuff. Had you know, I'm pretty much a single guy now.
I love the story. Was it, you weren't in the closet? Was the girl in the closet? Right?
Oh, yeah,
that's so good.
Wow,
it's our producer who's in the closet.
that was good. That was a biggie, and then the chick burnt the girl's clothes. It was a big debacle. But now I notice what I had to do because I tripped up on the last relationship. by not emptying the house out.
Which one was that? Is that the girl that I met at the news channel?
Yeah, the girl that was in the closet.
Oh.
No, then it's the Channel 11. Yeah, the Channel 11 girl was the one girl that found the girl in the closet.
Oh, right. Okay.
But then, like, I realized, here's what you got to do. Once you're finally, like, single and all the steady girl relationships are out of your life, you have to go through your house with a full-size fucking garbage bag. And, I mean, start in one corner of upstairs and end up at the other corner of downstairs and throw away. You know how many boxes of fucking tampons are in my fucking house? I swear to you, there had to be five boxes of tampons in my house.
You got a lot of
various bathrooms.
You got a lot of bathrooms, though.
And
so.
Yeah, I know, but I don't have like a vagina.
Yeah, but so hot.
I'm not using the fucking things.
The girls you fuck are not even old enough to have their periods.
I know. Jesus Christ. That, and then I go in the shower. And I realize now I got to throw away shampoo that I wouldn't use. I'm not using Pantene for fucking bleached hair. You know? And, it's the, and I realize, like, this is the shit I got to fucking throw out. I got to throw out fucking things, pumice for your heels. It's not like I'm using pumice for my heels. So the garbage bag was completely full. Out to the garbage. Boom. Start anew. That's it. Now I don't have to worry that, you know, someone's going to open something up that I got to explain. Not that I got to explain anything.
Yeah, you're pretty straightforward.
Like, but I don't like having a fucking, you know, oh, what, that? Yeah, well, girls leaves their tampons over my house. Yeah,
okay. So you deal with crazies, right? You're married.
Yeah, yeah.
They're okay. All you're single. A bit crazy.
No, I'm in a very happy relationship. 4 wisdom teeth out yesterday. Whoa. So it's enchanting around my house. It's enchanting.
Dude, it all depends. Did you knock them out?
That would have been easier.
I run into the craziest shit. Like, I got a text message from this girl that I banged.
I love how you're honest.
Yeah, dude, I'm gonna get fucked anyways. Like, true. This girl, like, this, like, 3 months ago, she might be listening to this right now. Who gives a shit? Anyways, she sent me a text. I haven't heard from her, and like 2 a.m. Imagine getting this text. Okay, hey, haven't heard from you in a while. I ran into some girl, some guy that said you were physically abusive to some other girl, and she used your name and this story for her grant essay to get into NYU. And I'm like, what the fuck? It's 2 a.m. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? I'm like, first of all, I would never, dude, never. Like, yeah. I would suck their toes just to see if they could suck my dick. I don't give a shit. You know what I mean? I don't care. And I'm like, this is fucking weird. Wow. And I've only, I know the girls I've dated. I mean, they're not going to NYU. Like, you know what I mean? They're not
students.
Not
for 15 years.
You know what I mean? Exactly. So I'm like, what the fuck? So I can't sleep now. So I send a message to the girl. I'm like, what are you talking about? This is fucking weird. So she, of course, does. And I'm thinking, is this a ploy to get me to call her? Because I haven't called her in 3-4 months.
Pretty good.
Like, what a fucking shitty way to do it. Just call me and say you want to suck dick. It's like, fine. So all of a sudden, like, oh, that's so bad. Hey, go see Ice Age. anyway, so I'm like, I don't know any girls going to NYU. I don't really hang out with the smart ones. I'm confused. You know, give me some more information. So as it comes out, literally until I just came to see you guys, all of a sudden the girl says, I said, you know, what's the girl's name? She says, Juliana. I said, Juliana. I only know 2 Julianas. They're from Brazil, and they're definitely not speaking English very well. And they're not going to NYU. And I'm like, this is bullshit. So then, of course, because I said, I'm going to call my lawyer and so get the name. Because I'm like, you know, like if this person is telling people that I'm beating her and stuff like that, like I don't even know her. Because I've heard other weird shit. Like I've dated girls I don't even know. I'm like, were they hot? Like, I'll date them. I mean, like, just come out and say, like, give me your number. But, like, I got no shame. But, like, any chance I can get. But basically, I said, so then the girl finally comes out and says, actually, a guy told me who's friends with her and said it was somebody that was in American Pie. I'm like, you bitch! It's 2 a.m. I've been thinking, like, some girl's thinking that I beat her. And I was like, just come out and say you want to go on a date. Because that's all it was.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, like, you would deal. You still probably deal with her, right? Even though you're married?
No, not really.
Don't you have girls coming up to you all the time? Or
oh,
you just,
well,
like...
yeah, because I'm, you know, I'm a good-looking guy. So, of course, that never ends.
Girls, I almost think once you're married, you get a chance for more pussy. Don't you think? I mean, like, it's all of a sudden girls.
Why
you don't
I'm
put
divorced.
Up that vibe.
Apparently he's right.
Because you're not throwing out that vibe anymore, so they get intrigued because you're not trying to bang them.
Totally. It's weird, man.
Yeah.
It's more of a challenge.
So there's my life.
I say
woman
three,
beater
though.
Right here.
Ice Age 3.
Ice Age 3, woman beater.
You're abusive.
What animal do you play in Ice Age 3?
I play a possum.
A possum, okay.
Yeah. You know who's in the movie, though? Simon Pegg. Who's
he's
do you like him?
Great, man.
He's Simon's
funny.
Hilarious.
He's a really funny guy. So the movie's actually really good. It's one of those things where I don't think Fox is going to mind, but if you get really baked. Most movies are really good when you get baked, but that kind of movie. And then you play Pink Floyd.
And sync it up.
I think the funny thing is everybody says
we all try that. No, it's when the lion roars
exactly,
the first time. Let's try that now.
It's at the second roar,
right?
You know what I'm trying to find, by the way, is the pastor with the baby voice.
Oh, we got
Marky,
little Marky.
What is it,
little Marky?
How long are you going to be in the facility? Because I know we have you till 10:30, but if you have a little time, we'll get you a copy now.
Okay, yeah, I mean, unless I go on YouTube and put, because I always put, like, pastors that have demon voices.
Yeah, we'll find
like that
it. Yeah, that's one of our favorite things. We haven't talked about Little Marky in a long time, but.
What is the last, like, weird scandalous thing that you guys saw? Or you heard about?
Oh, shit.
Like, the weirdest, I mean, of course, there's a lot that's going on last week, but, like.
Well, the Michael Jackson stuff is terrific.
Fucked up, right?
Like,
Billy Mays.
Yeah.
Come on.
Fuck, man.
Ed McMahon. The fact that everyone thought it was a heart attack, he got fucked to death.
That didn't happen.
I can't believe that three of the Lakers fucked Ed McMahon to death.
And there's going to be charges now.
There's going to be charges filed because they said they were just bringing him a jersey.
Wait, what are you talking about, dude?
Ed McMahon died.
I know, but he didn't get fucked to death.
Look at Sean.
Three of the Lakers.
Jesus, Sean. Sean Williams Scott.
And Phil Jackson drove them. That's a scandal.
Hey, a lot of people talk about your commentary on Dude, Where's My Car? Were you baked for that? Because people love it.
Oh, you know what? We were wasted. Wasted. But not baked. Just
drunk?
Because
people, I've never heard it, but I got to, because too many people bring it up and say that.
Really?
That you guys were hilarious on the commentary.
Well, I don't think we were funny. I think it was just funny that we were doing commentary for such a bad movie.
Right.
And the commentary was better than the movie.
It's
because we were just like, oh, good, another Jack Daniels. And like the whole time we kept, and then like when I would leave, Ash would be like, yeah, Sean had, a cold sore that day. He's sucking dicks. I'm like, I didn't know this. So I come back and he's like, hey, thanks for the drink. I'm like, cool, no worries, Ashton. I watched the fucking, like, thing. I'm like, you motherfucker. Fucking saying I had fucking herpes and shit. But, like, yeah, but I had a guy when we did interviews. I had a guy that goes, he goes, dude, I got to tell you, the movie's fucking horrible. But that's the best commentary I've ever seen. I'm like, thanks, dude. Why the fuck is everybody so honest?
Yeah, right.
You're honest. That's why. They feel like they could be honest in front of
I
you.
I think so.
Some of that commentary, though, is great. Like, Kevin Smith has some really good commentary on there where they're obviously, like, you know, I think one time a few of the people have been tipping some back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why not?
And he's a funny fucker. Anyways, that guy is so good. But, like, did you see he did the Carnegie Hall?
I was there, yeah.
You were there? Dude, like, awesome. I can imagine
first
a guy,
one I've seen. It's amazing.
Imagine a director, like, that popular.
Just him,
you know,
on a stage at Carnegie Hall, and he had,
for hours,
he had those,
like,
people.
Holds the,
it's incredible.
Crowd.
Amazing. I was bummed I had to leave early. It's like, fuck.
Yeah, he's funny, man.
One of the only times I didn't want to leave early.
Oh, you should come to set, man. It's pretty wild, dude.
Well,
like, you don't have time, right?
Yeah. No. We've had this discussion all day with celebrities inviting us places.
Oh, yeah.
And then we're not sure if you mean it or not.
Oh, I mean it.
I would love to go to the set of the Kevin Smith
movie. Dude, Kevin's not like everybody.
Yeah,
he's not full of shit. Kevin's a very nice dude.
Totally. But I'm not going to tweet him and go, Kevin, remember when you said.
No, he would love to have you on. It's true. He is so down earth. He's so cool.
We'll have to figure it out, because I would love. I've never.
That's a great movie to come to visit.
I've never been on a movie set.
It's
really?
I'd be like a little kid.
Dude,
yeah.
This is a good Bruce Willis is there. Like Tracy Morgan's hilarious. Yeah.
It's fucking
John McClane.
I know, right?
It's this sea of people, and then there's like, it looks like there's nothing ever gonna get done. There's too many people to shut them all up.
Yep.
And yet all of a sudden they're going rolling speed and everybody shuts the fuck up. It's amazing.
It's true, dude.
Everyone listens.
And then everybody's watching and they're going, fuck, I could do that. And they're all like going, wow, that's what it is? Like, these guys suck.
Are those guys bitter because they set up for like 12 hours and you guys just kind of roll onto the set, do your thing,
for sure.
Leave,
they
and then they have 4 hours
much.
Of breakdown.
Dude, they're the ones that have families. Like, they're the ones, all they do is they work to make us look good. And we come with, like, BLTs, and, like, we're eating sandwiches and shit's in our mouth.
There's an
they're, like, rolling
to
in.
Wipe your mouth.
Yeah, exactly. Like, somebody's holding the umbrella and they're like, these fucking guys.
Because living in New York, you get to see a lot of movie sets being set up.
up, and it takes for fucking ever.
Yeah, you never
and then you
see
guys
a celebrity,
just,
by the way.
Yeah, you roll in for a minute or two, an hour.
Yeah, we're sitting in the trailer watching, like, you know, Unbreakable or some movie, stuff like that. Like, can I get a couple beers? And like, and like 2 seconds later, there's like a six pack. Like, wow. And then everybody else is busting their ass, like setting up the lights. And we're like, we come in,
their asses off.
Like, wow, that smells like beer. I guess he's been drinking for the last hour.
But they'll stop it. Like, they'll start to go, oh, we got speed. And then they'll just stop it because, I hear a noise. Stop. And the whole production just fucking stops because a Yoo-Hoo truck beeped three blocks away.
Or the actor's like, I'm distracted. I hear a train. And it's like, I think it sounds, it's like, are you fucking kidding me? You're that bad of an actor. Like, you can't act through a train.
Right?
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Yeah, no, you gotta come to set. It is so funny. You'll be shocked.
Where are we at with this, Jimmy? This is our discussion all morning.
Kevin Smith.
Celebrities inviting
is,
us places.
Kevin is not a phony. He's not a phony either, man. I'm telling you, Kevin would find a way to let you guys sit there and watch. And it's a fucking amazing process to watch.
No, I would
He'll
go.
Make it fun, too, if it's because most movies are actually, it's fascinating because you just go, fuck, is this seriously it? Like, you're just sitting around and you're like, this is so boring. It's so much waiting. Like, there'll be times where we're like, we'll shoot for what, maybe a half hour, and then the 4 hours will go by and you only shoot for half hour, 40 minutes. Kevin's set is just cool, though, because he's funny as shit. And he's the kind of director where you come visit, you see it all get set up, and he's just funny. He's laid back, and you guys will be like drinking or whatever, smoking something behind the monitors, and he'll be throwing out lines. He's the director's like, okay, say this, Sean, say this, say this. And it's hilarious. And you get to see these things develop. And then, like,
that's
all of a
awesome.
Yeah. Other sets, like, I would definitely not recommend you going to visit, like, the sequel of Woodcock. Like, nothing would ever make that. But, like,
Kevin's vibe on the set is the same as it is. You'd be welcome there, dude. Totally. I mean, he's not being polite.
Dude,
he would welcome you.
If I don't feel
there.
Like I'm imposing, I'd be there tomorrow.
You wouldn't be imposing.
You know? Dude, definitely.
We told the story.
If the lights are on and the music's playing, just ring the bell.
Exactly.
Son of a bitch.
Greg Brady invited me to his house in LA, and I took him up on it. Next thing I know, he's like trying to figure out leftovers.
His name's Barry Williams.
Wait, what?
It's Greg Brady.
What did you say?
I was at Greg Brady's house.
Yes.
For real. And then he served me leftovers.
He was.
His name's not Barry. I've known
him
for years.
No. He gave you leftovers?
Yeah.
It's so much better he gave you leftovers than like everyone else.
Yes.
That's so great.
He was at the refrigerator with his wife whispering like, what are we going to serve?
I swear to God. Nothing in the house. I haven't seen a royalty check in fucking years.
Sean, I so obviously was imposing.
They gave you like a new, like for like a dessert, he gave you like a Nutrigain bar, like those Nutrigain bars, like the Apple version.
What was weird?
Is this a breakfast thing?
I guess you could, you know, drive with this at least, like get the fuck out of my house.
What was weird though, he had all the Brady Bunch episodes on VHS. How weird is that?
Oh, no.
You would think he would have been in the DVD world.
Now, let me show
Bunch.
You the Johnny Bravo episode again. You're going to love this one. I think I got to go.
But then he had
Barry.
Whole movies and just personal pictures. It was weird.
That is classic.
Because he's, like, you know, he's a big TV icon, you know.
Yeah.
Dude,
that's the one who dated the hot girl, right? Or married the hot girl, Greg? No.
I don't know.
Oh, no, that's Peter.
Peter, okay.
Oh,
Peter.
See, I only know
Peter was the middle
names.
One.
Peter. What were you going to say?
No, so you had to
Mike
go.
Mike Lookinland, the other one.
Mike Lookinland. Didn't
he's
he have
the one
that
got the
D-way. Shitty mustache?
Yeah.
Oh, he's awful looking now.
With the horrendous hairline.
With the Brady's. Yeah, does not end. They did not fucking age well at all,
oh.
Except the mother.
Oh. Dude, I'm so sorry. Oh, I got it. I knew there was something I wanted to tell you guys. I'm so sorry for interrupting. So I went on your website, like I was going and checking all the clips.
What is Foundry Music?
Dude, one of my favorite things is when you had the Brady Chicot and you said, okay, thanks so much, and you hung up on her.
it
was so good. And you're like, oh, my God, I can't believe you just did that.
Oh, Marsha Brady.
Oh, that was so good. Because, like, she's talking about her book. You're like, all right, thanks. And you just, like, hung up.
It was 15 seconds. We're like, are you psyched about your new book? She said yes. We're like, all right, thanks. I love it.
I rewound that so many times, dude. They gave me so much joy. Oh my God! Did she call back? Did her people call back? Say something happened?
Oh yeah.
Did you answer?
Nah,
her?
Nah. Why would we?
Listen to the in-depth Robin Leach interview. That was also a gem.
What is that one?
It makes that look like a fucking 60 Minutes piece.
Oh, can we talk about it or no?
It was just that short.
Do we have it?
Find
the Robin Leach before we let Sean go. He's got to get out of here.
Dude, that when you're like, all right, thanks, and you hung up, and it was just like a moment pause, and I think it was you. One of you guys started laughing.
Yeah, I was like. Oh my God!
Yeah, as he said. Oh my God! Yeah, can't
you're
believe.
Horrible.
Yeah, that's what you said. You're horrible.
He's constantly hanging
we
up
might
on.
Have it on YouTube. Let's see.
Well, we have a.
It's already funny.
Oh right.
David, can you please put you on hold, David? We have a.
Dave, hold on, please.
This may be a while. We have a celebrity guest calling in. We've
We have Robin Leach calling in, and we can't make him.
Yes. Remember Robin Leach, famous for Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. From the 80s and I guess maybe the early 90s, and I guess he's working on something new these days.
Yes, Robin.
Robin Leach.
Excited to talk to Robin Leach. Welcome to the Opie and Anthony Show. How are you?
Gentlemen, a very good morning to you.
Very good morning indeed, sir. Before we get into what you're working on, I need to know, what was the most expensive house you ever were in?
You know, it pales by today's rates. the most expensive house we were in was a...
Robin Leach, everybody.
The great Robin Leach.
Robin Leach. Still going strong after all these years. God bless him.
Probably one of the best interviews with Robin
I've ever heard. We learned a lot today.
Yes.
Good to know he's still doing. God bless his soul. Yeah.
Dude, no way. Did you know you were going to do that?
Oh, my gosh, dude.
And asking him the question he's been asked probably a million fucking times, too, right?
And he's just ready to say it. It had to be Clint.
Dude, that makes me so happy.
Oh, we have the Marsha
happy.
Brady? What
Marsha
the
Brady. Dude, that is awesome. Yeah, you guys are my idols.
We love those.
Oh, my gosh, dude. Did he call back, too?
Probably.
Who knows?
We let them field the cleanup after
oh,
us.
Oh, yeah, we just fuck it all up, and then everyone else has to explain. Oh, yeah.
You fuckers will do that to me when I'm doing American Pie 20. Yeah. So, Sean, what is it like playing American
Pie?
Well,
like,
bing.
You know, the first time. We click.
You fuckers!
If you ever do another woodcock, yes. We'll
do we have Marsha Brady?
Yeah,
all
right.
Nice.
Hold on, we're going to try this again. Maureen McCormick.
Good morning.
Hi. Hey, Maureen, you got a book out, right?
I do. It's called Here's the Story.
Oh, great, thanks. Joe, so.
Oh, great, thanks. Dude, that is so great. Oh, my gosh. Do you go home feeling so good? Like, just you know you did something special. Like, oh, great, thanks. What do you imagine, like, what went through her mind?
Oh, the phone must have had a problem. Yeah. Oh, nobody would be that big a dick.
Isn't she? Did she come on to that show where she was drunk?
You ever?
No.
Damn, I wish.
Wasn't there one where one of the girls from Brady Bunch was like, she's like, I thought it was her. I thought she was like... And she's doing a radio thing, and her kid was there. Like, she's probably drunk again. And like,
oh,
I think it was
wasn't that
wasn't it her?
I don't know.
Cindy. So it was Cindy.
Yeah.
Was it?
I don't remember.
So it wasn't her. It was the other, the younger one.
The younger one.
You have time to hear our Ed McMahon interview,
please.
Not Ed McMahon.
I got time.
Ed Asner.
Oh yes, I have time. Yes, of course.
That was horrible.
Ant was playing poker. I was doing the show with Joe Rogan. We were out there in L.A. because Ant was in a poker tournament, so he was
Rogan's
doing
an animal.
So we were just killing time and interviewing celebrities. Who else was there? Rogan and
he's funny, huh?
Rogan,
yeah. He's a good guy.
We love Joe.
Yeah,
and he can kill you with like his finger.
Oh, it's the Kristen Bell.
Oh, he's a fighter too.
Oh, fuck yeah!
All right, before that, we're doing a whole montage now for you.
Yeah, sweet.
Because
she's hot.
We found something you really like.
Yeah,
Kristen Bell's. We had a great interview with her.
Yeah.
We got to interrupt this news story. We got a big star on the phone, Kristen Bell, the star of Forgetting Sarah Marshall. Kristen.
Yes.
Congratulations on the new movie. Are you excited?
I'm so excited.
Awesome.
That is so awesome.
They're really funny when you hear them back to back to back, too.
Dude, it's so
funny when you hear them back to back.
Oh, my God, I feel so embarrassed, dude.
I know, isn't that
awesome. Awesome.
Oh,
is there another one?
The stupid tits one?
Yeah.
Do we have that one?
We'll get it.
Awesome.
It was Amanda Peet. Oh. Amanda Travis Peet. Just reminded me. Yeah.
Amanda Peet really hot, and then I was like, yeah, but your tits suck.
Oh, he was terrible.
I forgot exactly what he said, but I made fun of her.
I make you so many enemies right now, dude.
You got the Ed Asner?
Yeah, the Ed Asner is like
it's slightly longer, but
it's about a minute, okay. I think.
The Ed Asner one was fucking awful. We got him over to the table. It was Opie, myself, Rogan, and we're sitting there, and it just didn't go the way it should have.
Well, should we explain what we do to people?
First of all, you told him you were me.
No, I didn't.
Which fucked it up for something. Somehow he thought you were Anthony.
Oh, yeah,
though.
I didn't say that, though, but...
So you had a chance to bang Kristen Bell, and also now she's all like, right. What a dick.
I'm off playing poker somewhere.
Sure.
My ass handed to me.
I'll let you in on the thing, because maybe it helps when you listen to this. When we have some guests in here, and it just sucks, but they have people around and stuff, we'll go,
they're telling you have to go, Sean. And you're like, you get confused, but like, oh, well, they wouldn't just say that to me.
Right.
And it's a way to get out of
go.
It's a way to get out of interviews because we don't know what else to fucking do. We don't want to tell the guy he sucks, right?
Right.
But in this case, we went a little further with it. So, Ed Asner.
Fantastic.
You trying to get rid of me?
Yes.
What are you doing, Ben?
Ben, what are you doing? Making sign language.
What's the sign language?
Ed. That's Ben. And
he's our producer.
And he decides when a guest is getting a little too boring, and that was the sign that,
fuck?
He usually gives. And,
or Ben, disrespect to
Ed. We're having a good interview with Ed Asner.
I can tell you, Anthony, that that's the last time I'll ever be on your show.
No, that was... Ben.
I've suffered your insults enough. I certainly wouldn't come back again. I'll be glad to talk to you about the Columbia documentary some other time when he's not around.
Can I talk to you, Ed? I'm a big fan. I love you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Make sure that he's not in.
I don't. He does this all the time. I'm a big fan. I'm very happy to have you on the show.
He's a destroyer.
He's a destroyer.
Destroyer.
He's like Gordon Gekko. He builds nothing. Yeah. He liquidates. He's filthy.
A destroyer.
He's greasy.
Yes, he is greasy.
I don't want to smell his shorts.
He's a Sven Gala.
In quotes, I don't want to smell his shorts. Ed Asner.
Bravo.
The great Ed Asner. Thank you, sir. Very nice to meet you.
Thank you very much.
You're a destroyer. He called you a destroyer.
Wait till Anthony hears this on the replay.
Oh, it was phenomenal.
Hey, Jimmy, get back here, man. I started sweating. Ed, no, come on. Give me a handshake, please.
Fuck you, he said. Fuck you. Dude, Ed Asner just said, fuck you.
Oh, that's so awesome,
oh, that's
dude.
Phenomenal.
Fuck you.
The star of Up has a filthy mouth there,
dude,
Sean.
Dude, that is great.
They go on and on. We had Linda Blair on, and the only thing we would say to her is the power of Christ compels you.
Oh,
over
man,
and over
was
again.
That bad. That's all. Also, one of my favorites is when it was Colin Hanks and Jack Black with the midget. It's always funny to me.
The
I sit at home
crying.
When I'm sad sometimes. I see like one of my bad movies on TV, and I think about that clip of the small person like crying. Like Jack Black is confused and kind of uncomfortable, and they look at each other like
it was very uncomfortable.
Oh, it's so good.
For the new listeners, Colin Hanks, Tom Hanks' son, and Jack Black, they didn't know what they were really getting into. And this midget called us out of nowhere and said she wanted to become a stripper. So we're like, well, come on down. We know a thing or two about strippers. You could try it out. We'll give you some pointers. Yeah. And as she's taking off her clothes, she realized it was a horrible idea and starts crying in front of everyone while she's naked.
Oh, nothing worse than a naked midget crying.
Oh, dude.
While Jack Black and, you know, and Colin working on.
Sean has to go. They're your people. For real, look.
For real, not for real. Yeah,
you fuckers. For real, look.
Fuck you.
Look. You can't even see the nod for yourself. Does Sean have to go?
Actually, we got to get out of here.
Yeah, we have to go,
Fez
too.
Oh, good one. You got to fit a little extra.
Actually,
came over.
We got to
get out. Wasn't even a real producer.
Sean.
We are pointing to...
So a couple things. Role models, on demand. I loved it. Check
Thanks,
it out.
Bro.
Sean William Scott was great in it. And Ice Age 3, of course, which you don't really have to promote. That's going to just do great business.
Yeah, I think it's pretty fun.
And you're in New York for a while, so come back
totally
sooner
than
later.
Well, the reason why I couldn't come before is because we were shooting Crazy Nights. But now I'm off until the end of July. So if you guys want to go, I'll go with you to set.
That would be cool.
I'm the actor that actually goes to set because I have nothing else to do, even though I'm not working. But like, we should do that, man. That'd be awesome.
You're not in the movie anymore. You're done with the movie. No, I just figured I'd come down.
Exactly. Please just
this work.
Your part is so fucking funny, man. So funny. I read the whole thing.
Oh, you did? Oh, dude.
Damn,
we
good lines.
Oh, thanks, bro. We improvise so much. The guy's fucking hilarious. Yeah. I think you'll like
it. This is what I do. This is my number.
Nice.
And if you call and I don't feel like you're, you know, I'm imposing, I'll go down.
Dude,
there.
Seriously? All right, let's do it, man. Yeah. Kevin would love that, man. It's good to see you guys.
All right,
we're all
ending the show right now,
dude,
so we'll see you
awesome
guys tomorrow.
Man.
Ron and Fez
dude,
in 20
awesome
minutes.
Job too,
thanks for listening.
Fucking